into the day with the dawn ringing in my ears. Oh well, I tune to my TV show. No better way, I gotta get myself into gear. Let's go. Oh, and I feel good today with my wake up in the morning espresso.
Gilligan, how you doing? Welcome to it. It is a brand new day. Welcome from myself and the rest of your family this morning. Welcome to Expresso. Beautiful Monday morning. Hopefully you had an amazing weekend. You gorged yourself on all of the sports and you got all that family time in and you're ready to embrace a brand new week. We certainly are this morning. Why? Because we are going to be graced by the presence of an American superstar. Stacy Francis is in the house. She's worked alongside the likes of Chaka Khan, Prince, Morgan Freeman, just to name a few, in a career that has graced the stages of Broadway, the West End, and the silver screen. And I walked into her sound checking this morning, which is one of those special moments. You know it's going to be good. She's here in South Africa, and she is spreading her love one meal pack at a time. Can I wait to find out more about what she is doing here, why she is here, and just to hear this unbelievable talent sing. And she's here to perform just for you this morning. Two people I know are just as excited as me. Good morning, gang.
Good morning, G. Good morning to you, Mzanzi. A start of a brand new week, a start of a brand new day. You're on your Feel Good Breakfast Show. The 3rd of May, can you believe it? 3 days into May already.
Crazy.
I mean,
this year is just flying away.
It's flying by. It feels like we're in a different planet this morning. Speaking of our planet, we're asking on you on our social media, if you could take three things with you to Mars, what would it be? This is a tricky one.
I know you
probably have a bucket list of all the things you want to take already.
But I was first trying to figure out, like, what's the weather like? Are there waves? I mean, I need to know these questions. But I definitely think if the signal's good, and I heard this from Lucia as well, I'll probably take, like, a solar-powered charger, just so I can Instagram everything, you know, go live, show the people what's Mars. Yo, we're chilling in Mars right now. Instagram, what's up? And then maybe, like, some good seeds, you know, when I run out of my snacks. I want to plant some of my good fruits and flowers. Mm-hmm. So I'll definitely do that. And then, I don't know, maybe just the Speedo to tan in. I'm sure the sun's pretty good there. I don't know.
The Martians will probably look at you like, this man is in a Speedo, like, on our planet. What are you doing?
Maybe the Martians feature me on the account. You never know. Guys, always be ready. But let us know on our social media channels this morning. I'm going to ask Jamie this question later because I'm so keen to hear her answer. But you guys, come through with those answers on our social media channels. That's Expresso Show. Of course, you can find us on Facebook. You find us on Twitter. You can find us on Instagram. And you can find us right here live on your Expresso Show. It's S3B opening up. It's Monday, and we are live. And let's find out first up what's happening in the news with G.
Thanks so much, team. Let's start here in South Africa, where the city of Cape Town has obtained an interdict from the Western Cape High Court to forestall the unlawful occupation of District 6 land in central Cape Town. The interdict prevents anybody from occupying District 6 land or property. The city said it had received information that a group of people is intending to unlawfully occupy parts of the District 6 land earmarked for the rightful beneficiaries who were forcibly removed from the area by the previous government. And some housing developments there are ready for occupation. And staying in the country, the Department of Energy has published the latest fuel price adjustments for this month, showing a slight decrease for both petrol and diesel. Petrol, 95 and 93, will decrease by 9 cents per litre, and diesel by 30 and 31 cents per litre. The movement in prices is typically affected by two main factors, the international petroleum costs and the movement in the rand-dollar exchange rates. The changes will take effect from this coming Wednesday. Now, casting a wider gaze on the international front, Uganda has detected the Indian variant of the novel coronavirus, igniting fears that the East African nation could suffer a resurgence of cases just when its outbreak has waned. Pontiano Kalibu, head of the government-run Uganda Virus Research Institute, said the variant had been detected on a Ugandan who'd returned from a visit to India. So far, Uganda, like many African countries, has experienced a relatively mild COVID-19 outbreak. Meanwhile, in India, they've recorded their highest daily coronavirus death toll since the pandemic began. This just a day after it became the first country to register more than 400,000 new cases in a 24-hour period. Its health ministry said 3,689 people had died in the past 24 hours. This as hospitals are battling to treat patients amid a chronic shortage of beds and medical oxygen. Meanwhile, the UK said yesterday it was sending an extra 1,000 oxygen ventilators to India, and a group of doctors is offering offering long-distance telemedicine from Britain. And now we round off on a very positive note. A space shuttle liftoff inspiring a young boy to reach for the stars, literally. From the dusty streets of Katlehong in Ekurhuleni, Gauteng, in 1981, a young boy watched as the space shuttle Columbia STS-1 took off until it was just a tiny speck of dust in the sky. Well, this event inspired Zeblon Zenzele Vilakazi, who was born there on the 3rd of April, 1969, to reach for the stars. Last week, some 40 years later, this nuclear physicist was officially installed as the 16th Vice Chancellor and Principal of Wits University, rated as Africa's second best university, in fact. And he said, and we quote, "You do not usher in a vision in a moment of euphoria. You do it because the vision you are articulating is as important as the other challenges must match be." And the youngest of a family of eight, whose father ran a small shop in the community, he was one of the first students from Africa to conduct PhD research at the European Centre for Nuclear Research in Geneva in Switzerland. Vilakazi is also fluent in seven languages: French, German, Zulu, Siswati, Sesotho, Afrikaans and English. And he was hooded by Wits's Chancellor, Dr. Judy Dlamini, and we certainly tip our hats to him. On that very positive note is where we round off our news headlines. Let's get into the sport. Well, sending the perfect sign on an Olympic year in athletics, sprinter Akani Simbine led Team South Africa to a gold medal win in the men's 4x100-meter relay event at the World Relays in Silesia in Poland last night. The 27-year-old Simbine anchoring his team of Tando Glodlo, Gift Leoklela and Clarence Munyai to relay win in a time of 38.71 seconds. And on to local rugby, after scoring two tries in the last 14 minutes of the match, the Bulls recorded a pretty comfortable 24-9 victory over the Lions at Loftus Versfeld in the Pro 14 Rainbow Cup, the South African edition. This, of course, on Saturday. In the earlier fixture, a hat-trick by Locke, Hugo, securing a 33-30 win for the visiting Sharks over the Stormers at Cape Town Stadium. The Rainbow Cup action will continue this coming weekend. And staying with rugby, a last-minute try by CUT secured a stunning 23-18 win over the defending champions, Marties, at the Tuk Stadium in the Varsity Cup. Fullback Cohen Jasper scoring the match-winning try for CUT after an 18-all scoreline. In other results, UWC, they scored three second-half tries to beat out UJ 31-5. NWU, they recorded a very narrow 22-20 win over Wits. And Shimlas, they beat the Madibas 24-20. So all pretty close action over the weekend. And on to football, reigning champions Mamelodi Sundowns reclaimed the top spot in the Premier Soccer League after thrashing Orlando Pirates 3-0 at the Orlando Stadium yesterday. And on Saturday, AmaZulu FC went top briefly after edging out Golden Arrows 1-0. The Brazilians currently topping the table with 51 points, with Usutu in second with 50 points. It's going to go down to the wire. And other PSL results, Kaizer Chiefs and Bloem Celtic, they played out to a 2-2 draw. TS Galaxy beat Cape Town City FC 1-0. And Maritzburg United and Swallows FC, they both shared a point, 1-1 the scoreline there. Then some breaking news in the English Premier League. The clash between Manchester United and Liverpool has been postponed due to protest action at Old Trafford, the first time this has ever happened in the league. The Premier League said it was a collective decision by both clubs, police and league, that and the authorities to call off the fixture after about 200 fans broke into the stadium to protest against the Glazer family's ownership of the club. Discussions are in place to rearrange the game. And on the motorsport front, seven-time Formula One world champion Lewis Hamilton, he fought back to win the Portuguese Grand Prix ahead of Red Bull's Max Verstappen and his Mercedes teammate Valtteri Bottas. This was the 36-year-old's 97th Grand Prix victory. The race win at the Algarve International Circuit gave Hamilton an 8-point lead now over Verstappen. And then staying on wheels, that emotional Jack Miller stormed to victory at the Spanish Grand Prix in MotoGP yesterday. It was a 1-2 finish for Ducati after Miller cruised to his first race win in 5 years, and his Ducati teammate Francesco Bagnaia finished in second. Patronus Yamaha's Franco Morbidelli, he rounded off the podium positions in third, and South Africa's Brad Binder did not finish, unfortunately, after suffering two crashes in the race. Well, we'll delve a little deeper into all of the football and cricketing and rugby action in just a moment, so stick around for that. But right now, let's greet the day with some of your beautiful sunrise pictures.
Thank Thank you so much, Mr. G-Man, for that sports update. Yes, let's have a first look at the weather update. But firstly, thank you to all of you that took the time to photograph and share your gorgeous sunrise views with us this morning. It really is a great way to start each and every day. Now, today we kickstart the week with this beautiful view overlooking the lake in Richards Bay, shared by Carmen Morel Martin. Absolutely stunning. Now, Richards Bay can expect a pleasant day ahead, reaching a maximum of 23 degrees Celsius. Next, we also receive this stunning image of the sky from international viewer Charmaine Blackburn from Kalgoorlie, Australia. How beautiful are these colors spread across the skyline? Now, today you will have some brief showers in the morning with temperatures peaking at 17 degrees Celsius. It's going to be a beautiful day. Again, please continue to share your sunrise photos with us on the Expresso Facebook page. You may just see your photo featured here next time. Now, of course, while we enjoy experiencing a sunrise from your part of South Africa, we do have some international viewers tuning in on both YouTube and the Africa channel in the USA. And this morning we report on the weather for Salt Lake City, the capital city of Utah. Now, some summers are hot and dry, while winters are wet and cold, although not typically severe. Today, however, you can expect times of sun and clouds, with temperatures reaching a maximum of 19 degrees Celsius. Now, right now, let's turn to the hot topic of climate change. The world's glaciers are melting at an accelerating rate. This, of course, according to a French-led team who have assessed the behavior of nearly all documented ice streams on the planet. The researchers found they lost almost 270 billion tons of ice a year in the opening two decades of the 21st century. The meltwater produced now accounts for about a fifth of global sea level rise. They explained that if one took that amount of water and divided up across Ireland, it would be enough to cover all of Ireland in 3 meters of water each year. Now, although the rate of glacier melting has increased steadily, the pace has been dwarfed by the accelerating ice losses from Antarctica and Greenland, and they remain the primary concern for future sea level rise. The research team from the University of Toulouse in France used as its primary source of data the imagery acquired by NASA's Terra satellite, which was launched in 1999. The article appeared in Science in Action. Right now, though, it's time to have a first look at the temperatures for today. We start off with Polokwane. Do expect a low of 7 today, peaking at 20. If you're out and about in Umbombela, expect a low of 10 and a high of 24. Pretoria, for you, it is a minimum of 8 and a maximum of 22. Johannesburg ranges from 7 to 20. Mahikeng, 6-23. And then Klerksdorp coming through with a low of 5, peaking at 23 today as well. Kimberley, for you, it is a minimum of 7, peaking at 23. Bloemfontein ranges from 3 to 22. Richards Bay coming through with a low of 14 and a high of 23. And then Pietermaritzburg ranging from 9 to 23 as well. Durban, South Africa's playground, ranges from 16 to 24. Mthatha, 7-25. East London, for you, it is 14-25. And then Craddock coming through with a low of 7, peaking at 26 a day. Gqeberha, 14-25. If you're out and about in George, do expect a low of 14. And a high of 28. The mother city, Cape Town, coming through with a low of 14 and a high of 27. And then Worcester, for you, it is 13.30. Sutherland, for you, it is 8.21. And then last but definitely not least, Upington ranges from 12 to 28 today. But of course, wherever you find yourself on this Monday, make sure to keep it locked right here on your Feel Good Breakfast Show.
Monday. Someone's just walked into the building. Someone very special. Okay, we're going to be talking about the sport or the sport that maybe didn't happen.
Ooh, yeah.
Like Man United, yeah. Liverpool. What, the first time ever that they've had protest action stop a game of football.
It's such a big game as well. Gee.
Oh, man. It's all must win at the moment. We will delve into all of the footballing action. We're also going to get into a little bit of cricket. Big Vern is in the house.
Yes, yes.
Give us a little wave there. Look at that beautiful man.
Vernon Philander in the building.
So excited, man. We'll be connecting with him, catching up and finding out how he is in this crazy time. Mm. And then we will, of course, have Stacy Francis performing just for you. You don't want to go too far. We'll see you in a moment.
If your sunrise snaps are prize winners, give it your best shot on Expresso, and yours could win you one of those oh-so-chic Nespresso travel mugs. So snap your best sunrise and post it to the competition post on Expresso's Facebook page with the hashtag Nespresso Sunrise. Winners are announced Mondays on the show and competition closes the 5th of May. So let's be seeing those morning masterpieces.
Welcome back. You're live with Expresso as we talk a little sport after a bumper weekend, taking a look at what happened in the world of sport over the past 2 days. Highly anticipated English Premier League match between Manchester United and Liverpool, a must-win, certainly for the defending champions, postponed due to protest action at Old Trafford yesterday. First time it's ever happened in the league. And of course, Mamelodi Sundowns, they went off the summit of the table. Now they're back at the top of the PSL table after thumping Orlando Pirates 3-0. And in the IPL, the stars continue to shine. The Delhi Capitals seeding their 6th win in 8 matches to go top of the standings. Sports journalist Yolulwe Qoshe is standing by with all of the details. And Big Vern, Vernon Philander, now joins us on the couch to show us whether he's neutral or biased in the world of football. I know in a moment we're going to be chatting to him about an amazing initiative, but we thought we'd have a little bit of fun with you first. How are you doing, my brother?
Good very morning to you. I'm very good. I can't complain after a year and a half of a sabbatical. I surely can't complain, but yeah, very good, man.
You look fit, you look strong, dude.
I am strong. I'm very well relaxed and well rested, I have to say. But yeah, very good mind. How's things your side?
Yeah, good, man. I think it's been a crazy time for all of us. And I think you, like us, will probably savour every moment of live sport that we get to watch and sink our teeth into. Let's start with a little bit of football. Yolu, how are you doing, brother?
I'm all good. How are you doing, bro?
I'm good, man. You can see we've got royalty on the couch this morning, so savouring the chance here. But let's talk a little bit of football, my brother. You know, we started talking about the romantic story that could be AmaZulu. They did it. They won bragging rights in the Durban Derby, beating Golden Arrows to briefly take the summit away from the reigning champions. But how are you feeling about AmaZulu's charge at the moment?
Well, I mean, they are doing what they're supposed to do. I mean, all they can do is worry about themselves getting the 3 points and keep putting that pressure on Mamelodi Sundowns, you know. And a lot of talk about their coach leaving as well probably won't help the camp, but they're showing no signs of that affecting them at the moment. And all they can keep doing is putting on the pressure, keep trying to get those 3 points and hope Mamelodi Sundowns will falter again along the way.
What do you mean, talk of Benny leaving AmaZulu already?
Yeah, a lot of media outlets were running a story just yesterday about it already being a finalized deal. Apparently, Benny McCarthy will be announced as the new Bafana coach during this week that we're going into. And on top of that, the reports go further to confirm that he will be joined by his current assistants at AmaZulu, which are legends such as Siyabonga Nomvete and Muneeb Joseph. So that was a big story that broke yesterday, and it keeps developing all the time. So we'll just have to wait and see what the truth is. And that rumor was fueled by Safa coming out and announcing and making a statement on that. So when has Safa ever done that for rumors? You know, it's all looking ominous at the moment.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it's exciting from a Bafana perspective. You shaking your head there, dude. I mean, it's craziness. Is Benny the man for the job?
I was about to say that you call it proper journo. He breaks the news even before it's, you know, you know, meant to be made public. But yeah, I mean, Benny's, you know, what a phenomenal career, you know, season he's had with AmaZulu. And yeah, it wouldn't surprise me if he gets a national call-up.
Yeah, man, I mean, he's definitely the right job, but AmaZulu, please just let him finish the league and win the league, man. I want to see it happen. Of course, they've still got to get past the fact that Mamelodi Sundowns are looking every part a championship-winning side. 3-0 win over Orlando Pirates. Let's move across the pond now to the English Premier League. So when you say your game was cancelled last night, which side does that put you? Are you a devil, red devil or a red?
I'm the red devil on this occasion. And yeah, deeply disappointed that the fixture got cancelled. But hey, rather cancel than people get injured, you know. But yeah, deeply saddened. You know, I think it's the one fixture that the real rivals look forward to, Liverpool versus United, of course. But yeah, I mean, what a sad and pity that it got cancelled. But hopefully it will be played really sooner rather than later for all of us.
You can understand the frustration of the fans after the year not being able to be a part of the footballing journey with their teams. Take us through what that meant and what is the likely outcome here? I know it's a real bottlenecked kind of schedule at the moment. When do you think we're going to see a rematch between the two teams? And just how important was this game for Liverpool, especially in the context of these UEFA and Europa Champions League spots?
Yeah, like you say, Graham, it's a very congested time of the season now when it goes to the business end of the season. The Manchester United are still in Europe, so it's going to be hard to reschedule their game. But, you know, they've got the midweek games to contend with in Europe, and then they've got the league fixtures to have to honour as well. So it'll be interesting what time they'll be able to make for that particular fixture, because, like you say, it's a big one, and it really is decisive for Liverpool, like you've mentioned, because now a team like Tottenham last night got a very important 3 points to put pressure in terms of getting those top four positions, and Chelsea also got 3 points. So, you know, the pressure is going to tell on Liverpool if they don't get that game quickly enough and try to make up points using that game as well. They could be left very, very far behind in that fourth space challenge.
And I think for the Man United fans to know that they could completely scupper Liverpool's season with this match, I think that really does stand out. And of course, Spurs going up to fifth on the log with their 4-0 thrashing of, yes, relegated Sheffield United. But certainly looking back to their best under Ryan Mason, the youngest ever manager in the league, it's all going to go down to the wire. We're going to talk a little bit of rugby action next, and then we're going to get into Big Vern's incredible golf day, which I think you really do want to hear about. Stick around.
It's a juicy kaboom!
Oh yes, gentlemen, there was a whole lot of winning over the weekend, and we don't want it to end, absolutely not. Now, last week we played the first round of the Maynards hashtag Juicy Kaboom game live here in studio. It was juicy, it was fun, it was fruity, and most important of it all, it had that
juicy kaboom!
It's a juicy kaboom!
That's exactly it. And of course, this week, more cash prizes are up for grabs with a new competition question. It says, share your first memory of enjoying Maynard's sweet. And here's a reminder on just how the game works. It's lots of fun. You're going to show us exactly how it works.
Let me show you how. Yeah, so it's very simple. Obviously, we're going to have a viewer on the line phoning in, and then they're going to choose a presenter to do the deed for them. So the deed in this case, of course, is that I'm going to be throwing in these balls into the bucket, right? So viewer will phone in, and if you want to win this one, I would definitely suggest that you choose me, right? Because you're going to see my aim area. So presenters take turns. Myself and Jamie, as an example, take turns chucking the ball in the bucket. And that was a warm-up. And then once we get in the bucket,
it's a juicy kaboom!
Juicy!
You hear that noise? And whatever ball landed in the bucket, that will determine what prize that you get for the day. So, of course, if you chose me and you chose this bucket, you win yourself 1,000 Rand. Simple as that.
You just put a lot of pressure on yourself for the entire South Africa, because now you're saying they need to choose you as a presenter.
I'm your guy.
That means you could either make someone super rich or super sad on like every week.
But more potential to be rich, considering what I've gone through. I've trained for this moment. I got you, Mzanzi. Pick me. I'm going to make you a winner.
Yeah. Maynard is making it so sweet for us here in studio, from wine gums to jelly beans, jelly babies, and so much more. Everyone has their favorite Maynards. They can refresh, revitalize, and re-energize with a juicy kaboom! Remember, one lucky viewer stands a chance to play the Maynards hashtag Juicy Kaboom game live on air this Friday. Just reply to the competition post on the Expresso Facebook or Twitter page, sharing your first memory of enjoying these amazing Maynard sweets. Now, don't forget to include that hashtag Juicy Kaboom. We could be calling you to play and win cash prizes with us and Mr. Raldo Mona, as he says. Now, the competition runs until Friday, the 7th of May, 2021, and those T's and C's can be found on ExpressoShow.com. You want to give it one more chance?
1-1-5. Simple as this.
Another one.
Oh, no. One more. Oh, no. Maybe don't choose me.
Yeah.
Change my mind, guys. Choose someone else. I'm out of here.
Maynard, it's a juicy kaboom!
Welcome back. As we continue to talk sports and local rugby this weekend, the Pro 14 Rainbow Cup kicked off here in South Africa on Saturday with well-deserved wins for the Bulls and the Sharks. In CUT, they shocked defending champions Marties in the Varsity Cup as UWC, NWU and Shimlas all recorded wins. And then moving abroad, the Blues and the Hurricanes added their Super Rugby Aotearoa campaign. They ended it on a high. And the Brumbies, they are through to the final. They confirmed their spot in the Australian Domestic League final. Sports journalist Yolulwe Qoshe now joins us via video call to talk a little bit of rugger, and it's always great to be talking local South African rugby. Yolu, a good start, I think. I don't want to say brilliant, a pretty good start to our local rugby domestic season, if you will. A little bit of rust, maybe a bit of ill discipline on both sides, but a fantastic win for the Sharks, who I suppose had the form coming into this one. Maybe they were the outside favourites to beat the Stormers, but what did you make of Sia Khaleesi's return to his old club? And it looked like a pretty fiercely contested affair. I mean, he got tested on the day.
Yeah, for Sia Khaleesi, he was definitely tested. I mean, the opposite number six, a young man that is given the he's given way to Nama Kabo, had a really, really good game, and it tested him on the ground. But credit to Sia Khaleesi, his full array of skills was shown. He assisted one of the tries with a nice, very, very neat little or inside ball to a fellow player to dive off the try line, you know. But in terms of the game itself, very, very tightly contested affair. Didn't look like it was going to be that way, in fact, for the first couple of minutes of the first half. As it looked like the first the Stormers were going to run away with it. But the game leveled itself up at some point. Credit to Hugh Hope for the three tries for the Sharks in that game. And yeah, they really, really showed character to bounce back and get the victory.
Well, good signs if you're scoring tries through the tight and you know your set pieces are working. And obviously a rash moment. I think he just lost concentration for a moment. Siobhelo Sanatla being sent off with a red card. And that's never great in a game like this, especially, you know, we want to see him play, man. He's just such a prodigious talent. But I think a lot of character shown by the Sharks to fight back and win after a bit of a scare in that second half. And then we've spoken about what Jake White has done at the Bulls. This was a bit of a test for the Bulls side and for the Lions. In fact, the Lions kind of playing a few new combinations. They're not, I would say, the full-strength Lions team that we are used to seeing. What did you make of that encounter at the Yipske?
Yeah, definitely. I think both teams, in fact, you know, a lot of people see what Jake White has done with the Bulls. And what makes this that so incredible is that it is still a team in transition itself. There's still new faces being added all the time. So both teams are teams in transition, you know. But the difference maybe is that the Lions are transitioning with a lot more young players. And that's why their results have been indifferent. But that was a huge test for the Bulls. You know, the Lions came up, they fronted up to the challenge. They showed good character and they ran them pretty close. And, you know, that game showed just how impactful the new laws are, which include the captain's challenge, which for the viewers who might not understand that what that is, it's just the captain being able to go to the referee and ask the referee to review certain things in the game. I think maybe two or three tries from the Bulls were overturned by that, and that kept the game close.
Yeah, and I love that moment of, like, hesitation when the ref is it going to be a call? Is he going to talk to me now? Is it not? They're still clearly finding their feet with that one as well. But a great new addition to a really exciting competition next weekend that continues the Rainbow Cup action. Let's talk Varsity Cup action, and I stress the word action because this weekend was a lot more closely contested than the previous thumpings that we saw in last week's action. CUT 23-18 over Marties in the context of this season. That was a massive win.
Massive, massive victory for CUT. And it just begs the question about the Marties side. You know, is this a transition year for them? Are we expecting them to be like the other Marties teams that have just been dominant in the last couple of years? Are the Marties faithful now supposed to just manage their expectations with regards to their team? But we can also look at it in a way of just saying teams like CUT have now stepped up. And the level of competition in the competition itself has just gone up a notch, and that's how it's going to be from now. Credit to CUT after being thumped by a team they were expected to go par for par with UCT last week. They really fronted up, showed character this time around, and they showed that maybe that was just a blip, and they might really be the real deal after.
Yeah, completely, man. And of course, I suppose Marty's still in that playoff position contention, so they'll be happy there. Buddy, thank you so much for joining us this morning. A quick roundup of the rest of the results. The Hurricanes beating the Highlanders 41-22, and the Blues getting one over on the Chiefs. But of course, the Chiefs resting about seven players there ahead of their big Super Rugby Aotearoa final. They made it through in the previous week, so that was a bit of a dead rubber there. There they'll be facing the Crusaders. And of course, the Brumbies are through to Australia's Rugby final after beating the Western Force 21-9. That's where we wrap up our weekend sports. Now we're going to throw it forward to an amazing golf day. And Big Vern is in the house.
Oh yes, Mr. G-Man, of course, the Tigerberg Hospital Children's Trust is proud to announce that their inaugural Golf Day will be taking place on the 13th of May in Paarl. Mm. Now, the event will be showing support and raising funds for this amazing trust that helps underprivileged children right here in the Western Cape.
It's exciting. It really is such a big time of the year. To Tiger and the former South African cricketer, Vernon Philander, they invite you to the event, which promises to be nothing short of fun, filled with amazing giveaways, which we all love, competitions and auctions. They are such a big part of it. And this morning, Vernon is joined by the CEO of the Tigerberg Hospital Children's Trust, Jason Falcon, to tell us all about this incredible event. Guys, the moment has come. That time of the year. Welcome.
Thank you for having us.
Jason, I'll start with you, obviously being part of the trust. What does this mean to you guys to actually have a day set aside to have people like Vernon, you know, just use their platform and encourage people to come out in Paarl?
No, it's absolutely amazing, especially to have an ambassador like Vern supporting us and our kids. Mm. It's an absolute amazing experience. As far as the golf day is concerned, it's now almost 2 years in the making. Of course, last year events were completely closed. So we are really, really looking forward to having our first event in a very, very long time.
Well, this is fantastic. Big V, Big Vernon, you're such an important part of this entire exercise. What was it about this trust that really drew you and made you want to be a part of it?
Look, I think for me, first of all, I'm from Ravensmead. Tigerberg Hospital is obviously situated in Ravensmead. So it's right on my doorstep, man. I mean, I can't say no to that. And I mean, the hospital plays such a pivotal part, you know, in the upbringing of young people. And especially, you know, the children side of things, you know, you really have to make sure that, you know, the young children do have a proper health care. And, you know, that's exactly why I think Jason reached out to us. Of course, the Tutu Tiger stems from the Archbishop Desmond Tutu and his patronage, you know, with the hospital. And we've all agreed that, you know, the Archbishop, you know, yeah, he's getting on in years and, you know, you won't be able to fulfill his boots, you know, moving forward. And that's where us as Tutu Tigers come in, you know, really to take over that baton from him and really make, you know, the hospital a greater place and for people to actually come to. And like I said, it's such a pivotal part of the community in itself. So, yeah, we have a massive role to play. And I think we're fortunate that we can, you know, play that role, especially, you know, where we're finding ourselves. And fortunately for myself, you know, sport has given me that platform to really speak out to a lot of people that, you know, can relate to myself as well. And, yeah, I mean, again, being a part of that community, just, yeah, it's such an honor, you know, to be a part of it.
You've of course hung up your cricket balls. Does this mean now we're going to see you on, you know, the golf field?
Cricket boots, not balls. Eh? yeah, I mean, funny enough that you mentioned that. I'm actually going to be back onto the park at the end of the year again domestically in South Africa. But yeah, you know, for me, just to be a part of, you know, initiatives like this, it's such a humbling experience, you know, to go to the hospital, to see, you know, what children are going through on a daily basis and really just to understand the need that, you know, that's out there. So, yeah, I mean, I can personally, you know, share with everyone, you know, that there is a massive need for us to, you know, raise big funds in order to keep the hospital going. And I mean, compliments and hats off to your guys like Jason, you know, that's doing it on a daily basis. But yeah, I mean, our job is merely to create awareness, to help raise funds and yeah, to make it a better spot for everyone.
Jason, what's the response been like so far as you sort of lead up to the 13th of May? How's everyone feeling at the hospital and I suppose around the community as well?
Well, it's been interesting. I think there's been a lot of nervousness and unsureness about events, you know. People are very eager to participate in the events, but we're not quite sure where we are yet. So it's been slow, but in the past 2 weeks, it's been a massive ramp up. I think we've sold all our four balls and more. Ah. So we are looking forward to a super, super great event coming the 13th of May.
I love it.
If people do want to get involved, how can they register for the four ball game?
Yes, they can mail us. It's the best way. admin@tigerbergchildren.org.za. Or they can just go to our website, which is tigerbergchildren.org.za, and they'll find the details there.
This is fantastic. So even though you've sold out on all of those tickets in that regard, people still can get involved. This is really great work that you guys are doing, I think, for the community at large. But I think it's such a positive story to tell that the entire country can take, I suppose, a leaf out of. Thank you so much for putting this together.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Love it. Love it. Well, a big thank you to CEO of Tigerberg Hospital's Children Trust and former South African cricketer. It's on Vernon Philander joins us once again, of course, this morning. Thank you very much. All these proceeds from the event will go towards the Tigerberg Hospital Children's Trust, which is such a fantastic platform.
Welcome, you beautiful souls. We're back, we're live. It's right here on Espresso, and we are opening up with S3, of course. Now, we've got some famous people in the building. We've got some superstars, one of them obviously being that legend, of course, in the building. But before we get into it, we've got so many South African cricketers that are doing so much. We've got AB de Villiers, Faf du Plessis, Quinton de Kock, and among so many others that have shown off such exceptional cricket skills at the Indian Premier League competition. Now, former cricketer, and our guest this morning, of course, if you missed him, it's Vernon Philander in the building. He may have retired from the game, but he will always be remembered as one of the most talented bowlers for the Proteas. And if you're lucky enough to see him play in the Western Province, you'll see some more of that coming up. But in order to play the gentleman's game like the best in the business, you need to train like the best. So a successful cricket player needs to have a core strength, good balance, coordination, speed, and of course, overall, some good power. So this morning, I'm going to be showing you how to train like a professional cricketer, and I got my friend Tapiso Makubela in the building. Yes.
That nobody warned me about the fact that I'd be training with you this morning.
But I like that, Tapiso.
So please excuse my outfit.
No, this is perfect because what you're going to be explaining and exploring is the fact that Mzansi has no excuse. Even without gym equipment, you can still do this workout.
Okay, cool. So you literally could be at the office and just decide take a bit of a break and get exercise.
Yeah,
I love it. Let's get going.
So what I'm going to focus on, obviously, we've got the core, we've got a bit of full body, but the most important thing for me when it comes to cricket player, shoulders, man.
Okay.
You're throwing the ball, you're batting, you may be catching in crazy positions.
Yeah.
We really want to strengthen these bad boys, all right?
Okay. All right.
So we're going to do something really simple to start off with.
Yeah.
It's called eyes, Y's, and T's. All right, does that make sense? Eyes,
Y's, and T's. Okay,
so we're going to literally create these shapes with our body.
Oh, okay.
So you've got a Y, you've got a T, and we've got eyes.
Okay,
and what we're doing in these positions is we'll start off with the eye, and we're going to work on our rotator cuff. So keep your elbows in that straight line, and literally just rotate your arms so your hands goes forward in front of you. Yeah, that's it. And then rotate back again. So you're really twisting your elbows. Yeah, so we're going forward and backwards. This is going to really warm up those rotator cuffs. I don't know if you're feeling anything in the shoulder there.
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah, and keep rotating it. So as you're pushing forward, Tubbs, don't use your elbows. Keep them on the side and just rotate your hands. Yeah, there we go. That's looking good.
I can feel it, yes.
Get that smooth transition. You'll feel some tension. That's because the shoulder's often tight. And for a lot of cricket players, you want that range.
Yeah.
We want to be able to throw it, all right?
Okay.
So we're going for 20 reps of that. Once we're done with our eyes, we're going to go
20.
20,
nice.
Yes. We're going for our Ys.
Okay, cool.
And another great option, if you guys are finding this too easy, you can actually lie on the floor and do this.
Okay, cool.
Makes it 10 times harder. So imagine the floor is over here.
Yeah.
Obviously lifting your hands up.
Yeah, that can't be easy.
Not easy at all, right? So let's go back to our Ys now. Mm-hmm. Obviously, so we just bring our hands straight in front of us, mm-hmm. all the way up in front of your head, back as far as you can. You want to stretch it and then bring it straight forward again. So this is really a nice warm-up, really a nice conditioner, getting your mobility, and really start to open up your hands more and more as you are progressing through this exercise. Again, 20 reps in total, sitting with a jersey, a pair of jeans, looking as good as ever, but
I mean,
no sweat, man.
Drip is forever.
Drip is forever.
What's next?
All right, so we've got I's, Y's, and then the last one was the T's. And the T's are very simple, so we're literally just coming in front of us and then going straight backwards again. There we go, and then in front, and then backwards again.
Oh,
and
you guys are going, feel good, eh?
Yeah, just the
I
fact
think
that
even
you...
as like a morning stretch.
Literally, eh? Exactly that type. So just to open up the body, often when you're lying and you're sleeping, you're curled up and you're quite tight. So opening up your diaphragm, opening up the rest of your body is really just gonna alleviate some of the pressure and stress we built up in the evening and kind of just get our breathing back, all right? Let's get to the big boys now. So
let's do it.
We're gonna do I guess it's a whole body exercise, a full body exercise, but we're also keeping it cricket specific.
Okay.
So one thing I learned back in my cricketing days, way back when, was in order to field and stop the ball, you can't just put your hands down and get the ball over here because it could bounce around, slide through your feet. So they teach you to actually make a defensive wall, right? So you put your foot against your knee, right? That whole knee is on the ground.
Yeah.
And now you can see if the ball was to come anywhere in this position, then if I was to miss it with my hand, it's just going to hit my leg and I can stop that boundary.
So you still caught it?
Yeah, so you still caught it or stopped it. So what we're going to do is create an exercise out of that.
Cool.
So you're going to have your feet nice and wide apart, okay? Kettlebells in your hand, nice, good weight over here, and we're literally going to rep this out. So you're rotating to the side, go into the fielding position. There we go, nice little lunge. Keep your arms nice and straight, explode up, boom, and then transverse to the other side.
Okay, cool.
Back down into that fielding position, all the way low, boom. Up all to the other side. There we go. So that's a nice flow. It's perfect for all you fielders out there. It's going to stop you from getting a four or six through that boundary. And at the same time, it's a great conditioner. We're working the hips at the same time, opening up our hips, working the pelvic region, also then emphasizing a skill, which is actually stopping the ball in cricket. And it's perfect for all your fielders.
So you actually also sort of figure out your form, right? You sort of master it in that process.
Exactly that.
Really awesome.
Last but not least, Tubbs, I'm going to ask you to get our bottoms on the ground now. You can keep your feet on the floor, but have them at about 90 degrees. To finish up, we've literally done a full body workout already. We've done the upper body, we've done the legs, and of course the core, which is so important for your batters, swinging, hitting those boundaries. I want you to keep your kettlebell in the air. This time though, you want to keep it straight up. All right, and now you're going to do big swings as if you were a cricket player, hitting that ball, swinging across. You can see I'm working the shoulders as well as my core, and this is an advanced movement of those Russian twists. Mzanzi.
Yeah. And those have never been my favorite, eh?
You guys can try for 3 rounds in total. Of course, you can see how easy it is. Tabisa's wearing...
Is it really easy?
You haven't broken up a sweat. So you got no excuse, of course. Go for 3 rounds in total, 20 reps each, and you're on your way to becoming a cricket superstar. Enjoy.
He was not ready. He was not ready. I don't want it to seem like I'm laughing at the expense of one of my colleagues, because I think he knows how much I love him. And Jenny Morris knows how much I love her, which is why we accept beautiful tributes of love on our show and a tea brought from hubby. That's just beautiful. Oh, man, absolutely love it this morning. The best way, I think, to maximize your workout, this is just for you, Tabiso, is with a nutritious post-workout meal. And enjoying a meal-free, meat-free Monday is far more delicious and easy than you realize. We're going to make it simple this morning, and best of all, it's better for you and for the planet. And our BeWell pea pesto pasta with balsamic roast tomato is the perfect way to refuel and enjoy a mouth-watering meal. Jenny Morris... Take it away, girls. Take it away.
Well, what a tribute of love. Absolutely.
Hey?
That was a mouthful. Peas.
Pesto pasta.
Okay. So.
We love our alliteration. And we love our pasta, and we love a meat-free pasta as well.
Absolutely.
We really have been making strides. I think where we started with our meat-free kind of drive, and it shouldn't just be on a Monday, It was like we were making do. Now, yes. These meals are amazing. Don't skimp on the flavour.
No, absolutely. And this is the thing. This is so packed with flavour. Mm. So we got some basil leaves. I'm going to get you to sort of pack everything into it.
You tell me and I will...
And then we have these beautiful frozen peas. They're vibrant and they're gorgeous. Lots and lots of texture. Literally, in the same water, you're going to cook your pasta. 30 seconds, zip.
Boom, boom, boom. So this
Absolutely.
Is quick.
Absolutely.
And I suppose with something like this, you don't want to kind of cook away all the beautiful nutrients.
No.
It's bright and colourful for
exactly.
a reason.
Exactly.
All of these going in here.
Totally. Oh, yes, darling. I'm a greedy girl. I want all those things in there. And then some garlic, antioxidant, antibacterial, antibiotic, antisocial. Who cares? Just whack those into that.
It's not antisocial as long as everyone has some. I think that's the key.
I force them. And then nuts. I've got some beautiful pine nuts here, but you can use cashew nuts, walnuts, any nut, actually.
But I think a pine nut is great for a pesto,
it's a
traditional pesto.
It's a treat, trust me.
Yeah, there we go.
And then some salt and pepper. I'm going to just give it like a pinch because the cheese will have a bit of saltiness
to it.
You can put a little bit more than that.
Okay.
And you can always adjust it once you do the tasting.
Okay.
Sometimes I just like fling a lot of salt into it. And you need salt because you need flavour. We need a little bit of liquid, some lemon juice. And my hands are sanitised.
Nice.
Anything I touch, you can touch.
Rest assured that we have been sprayed umpteen times.
Oh, absolutely. And then I just push it down a little bit with your spoon, make a little bit of space.
There we go.
And then we're going to just add this Parmesan or Pecorino.
Is it all going in?
Oh, yes, darling. It's all going in. Keeping a little bit for the top for you because I'm going to feed you.
There we go.
I've roasted some tomatoes up front. And then about two beautiful big heaped tablespoons of the beeswax. Now, what's nice about this is if you're a vegan, vegetarian, fantastic. If you're vegan, you can just replace the hard cheese with a lovely vegan hard cheese. And this is the beautiful tangy one.
It's 100% dairy-free. Okay. Okay, so that you can keep this completely vegan if you want.
Yes.
It's gluten-free as well. So you don't have to feel guilty about getting that beautiful tangy flavour. And I like that we're using the tangy.
Yes.
Because that's all
it just gives a bit of an extra kick. Now, what I've done is I've just taken my Beewell olive oil and I've just, and some balsamic glaze, and I've just tossed the tomatoes in them and go. And pop them in the oven. Just give it a shaky shake.
This is going to need a bit of a... Yeah.
Let me give you a little drop of water. Bring it here.
This is worth noting.
Yes, just a tiny little drop. And then you just blister them under the grill in the oven. And what you could also do is just do them in the pan. Sometimes I'm so impatient. Look at that. Oh, yes. Looking gorgeous. Look at those gorgeous.
Just
give it a little bit of shape. You make a little pea cocktail here, darling. A little pea cocktail. There we go. Maybe I was just like a little bit to put all the peas in. That's looking delicious.
There we go.
Done.
It's on its way.
Because as much as you want it nice and smooth, I like to get those little bits of basil.
The texture, yeah, pops of flavour in it. Yeah.
Very important. Now just whack that into there for me, G. And if you're good to Mama, she's going to feed you some de pasta, huh?
Ah, but I love this. It's quick. It's simple. You're not cooking out any of the beautiful
nutrients. Nothing.
Get it on there.
There we go. And then just keep that spoon. Normally I lick the spoon, but...
Such is the chef's right.
Just look at this. Doesn't this look
beautiful.
Gorgeous and vibrant? There is a knife and fork for you there.
Thank you, dear.
I'm going to just take some from here. How hungry are you?
I'm always hungry.
Always hungry.
But leave a bit for Tabiso.
Should I leave some for Tabiso?
He's earned the right this morning.
Well, he has. Actually, he could do with a bit of building up. Hey, my little baby boy.
Lots and lots of beautiful.
Chuck another little.
I'm going to try. I love the balsamic glaze.
It's gorgeous.
On the tomatoes.
And there are layers of flavour in here. You've got the saltiness of the cheese, you've got the sweetness of the tomatoes, and that lovely burst of juice. Mm. Isn't that gorgeous?
The balance of the salty and the sweet is spectacular.
Total.
There is so much flavour crammed into this. Absolutely beautiful, guilt-free. Like Jenny said, you can go completely vegan if you want by finding a cheese substitute. 100% dairy-free, 100% gluten-free. The Beewell And it's such a beautiful layer. And that tanginess does come through.
Absolutely
superb.
Yeah.
You can find this recipe on expressoshow.com. Try this tonight. Superb.
Mm. Yum, yum.
Sure, this is good, eh?
Rich taste that says, you've arrived. Living a life of illusion. Leaving your finances on the rocks. In this world of Bazotinabant, do you want a bank that takes your money? Or a bank that takes your money seriously?
Yes, welcome back to it, your feel-good breakfast show. It is Expresso. We're live here on S3. Thank you very much for choosing to wake up with us at the start of a brand new week and a brand new month. Now, listen to this. Her voice is powerful. Her stage presence, let me tell you this, is undeniable. Her star only continues to rise. Born in Brooklyn and raised in the church, Stacy Francis went on to work with the likes of Chaka Khan. Let me rock you, Chaka Khan. That's all I want to do. Prince, as well as Morgan Freeman in a career that has graced stages of Broadway and the West and just sharing her star all over the place, as well as the silver screen. Now, before she takes at the Expresso stage throughout the morning, which I can guarantee you guys are going to love, we want to get to know her a little better. So everybody, a warm Expresso welcome to Stacy! Yes!
Thank you so much. That's quite the introduction. Thank you so much.
Good morning.
Thank you. Good morning. How beautiful is this one? You get to sit next to everybody.
I get to sit next
She's
to
so
you,
pretty.
Ladies.
Thank you. I mean, when I saw her when she came, I was like, you're the host, right? You're the host. She's so pretty.
You guys even look alike somewhat, right?
Yeah, just less I like it.
The hair. I would take it. I would take it. Anybody who was raised in the church,
yes.
They just do a thing. They have this glow
Thank
up. And that's where you. That's where your story began. You began in the church.
Yes.
Went on to West End, Broadway, yes. Silver Screen. Tell us all about your journey.
Well, I grew up as a preacher's kid in Brooklyn, New York.
Wow.
Yeah, and so obviously I was in church literally every day. I literally grew up above the church.
Hello, Green
yeah,
Leaf.
It's true. We had a church downstairs. My uncle is my uncle's church, and we had a church downstairs, and I was downstairs like every day with usher meeting and choir, you know, and so I grew up in that environment, and then that was an easy transition to Broadway because obviously living in New York City and being inspired, my first show was when I was 16 years old. I started in a show called Mama, I Want to Sing.
Oh, yeah?
And it was very interesting because I didn't realize growing up in the church, it was setting me up for the stage. I didn't have stage fear, you know, and it's set because I was singing all the time from the age of 2 years old.
Yeah.
So I was very comfortable. So it was kind of like my training ground, the church. So obviously, you look at Aretha Franklin and Whitney Houston yeah. and the likes of those voices. It's because we sing all the time,
and
you know?
I think the church environment, especially with the choirs, really does mold you into
it does.
A confident, strong on stage type of performer.
It really does.
But your mainstream career, this is such an interesting story. I mean, mean, that took off with the group X Girlfriend. Yes. What was that experience and that journey like? How did it all form in that sense?
Well, I was, like I said, I was in Mama Wanna Sing, and someone actually referred me to the audition. They recommended that I go to the audition for X Girlfriend, and we signed with Benny Medina, who manages Jennifer Lopez. He signed me when I was 17 years old, and wow. We did two albums on Warner Brothers Records that hit Billboard Top 100s, and I toured the country more times than I can count. I've been to Japan, and I've been around the world. It's been a very big blessing for me.
How are you not tired? How are you not exhausted? I love it.
That was quite a while ago, and then I went to, after that, that career moment in with records, I love the stage. Yeah. I mean, I love singing live, and so I performed live with Chaka Khan on the West End, and that's where I met Prince, and he flew me to Minneapolis, and I recorded with him. I sang with him in Paisley Park. We did concerts together. Wow. I was telling a friend of mine, who you meet later, Craig, yeah. I was telling him that that Prince gave me a tambourine from the MPG, and you know, so it's interesting. I've worked with Aretha Franklin. I sang backup for her. I sang backup for Madonna. I've been on tour with Beyonce. You know, it's been very, very interesting. It's
been a look at this. Journey. I'm picking up my jaw.
Oh, that's so sweet. That's so sweet. That's so sweet. That is very sweet. Yeah.
And then obviously you entered the 2011 singing competition. That also took off brilliantly, set you up for your career, yeah, as well. What did you take away from that experience?
Well, it was interesting because my earlier career, I never felt like I had really reached what I wanted to reach as far as my goals, like really as a solo artist, because I was singing in a girl group and I never felt like I had reached the goal of solo artists, you know, that Mariah Carey status, or I never reached that, and I just felt like I was short, I had fallen short of that.
Yeah.
So I wanted to go meet Simon Cowell, and I wanted to see if he would, you know,
recognize
that. Yeah, recognize, there he is.
And, I mean, what was that experience like? I mean, you obviously, having spent so many years sharing the stage with so many great artists, now stepping into a space where you have to be so vulnerable with your art and your talent, did you feel that it would be an easy breeze because you already had the foundation and such a strong one at that?
You know what? I was freaking out.
Really?
I was freaking out. It was Simon Cowell, you know? I'm like standing in front of him. I felt like an 18-wheeler truck was gonna run me over. I was so scared. But you know, when he stood up, you know, he stood up and he applauded me. I had put his picture on my wall like a couple of months before I met him. I mean, I'm really into visualization and putting my reality, you know, just praying and, you know,
manifesting.
I'm really into that. Yeah. And it was kind of like a dream board that I created. And I put him on my wall and I was like, I want to meet Simon, you know, because at that point it had been a big gap in my career. And I was thinking, you know, at this point I'm over 40, what am I going to do? Who's going to want to work with me? And I knew that he had signed people over 40. He worked with Susan Boyle. And I thought, okay, he can be my hope, you know? So I put his picture on the wall, and 3 months later I was standing in front of him. It was so magical. It was so, so magical. And he stood up and he applauded me. He stood up.
Insane.
And I don't know if you've ever seen the footage. I always get teased. Like, I have memes. They have memes of me with the black eyeliner.
Well, you shouldn't have told us that, because now we're going to go find that meme. And we're going to use it lots on our
about
pages.
Me. I'm just like, because it was just really emotional. And he believed in me. And it was just really incredible. And honestly, it's a part of my passion right now to inspire people to never give up. You never know what's going to happen. You can't give up, you know? And look at me now. I'm just like really, really excited to share my journey with people. I have my nonprofit and I'm giving back, and it's just really, really exciting to talk to you about my career and to really, you know, to really think about it. It's just been a really blessed journey.
It really is such a blessed journey. Absolutely. And I think you're going to be blessing us all throughout the morning.
Yes, Stacy Francis is not going anywhere. She's going to be speaking more about that nonprofit organization that she runs here in Alsace River, so stick around for that. But she has performances coming your way here on your Feel Good Breakfast
and the
show.
Memes are also and coming. It's coming to you this morning.
That's so funny.
Well, we'll check the memes for just a moment as we move into the top of the hour. In fact, 1 minute past seven, let's get back into our national news. Forestry, Fisheries and Environment Minister, Barbara Creasy, yesterday released a long-awaited high-level panel report on the management, breeding, hunting, trade and handling of elephant, lion, leopard and rhinoceros. The report noted that captive lion breeding did not contribute to conservation and damaged South Africa's reputation abroad. The majority of stakeholders supported ending domestication of the country's lions by outlawing breeding and commercial use of the big cats, a massive step forward. The panel recommends that South Africa does not captive breed lions, keep lions in captivity, or use captive lions commercially. Now, the city of Cape Town has obtained an interdict from the Western Cape High Court to forestall the unlawful occupation of District 6 land in central Cape Town. The interdict prevents anybody from occupying District 6 land or property. The city said it had received information that a group of people is intending to unlawfully occupy parts of the District 6 land earmarked for the rightful beneficiaries who were forcibly removed from the area by the previous government. Some housing developments there are already ready for occupation. Now, onto the international front, or even beyond our planet's borders. Four astronauts have returned to Earth from the International Space Station in what NASA's calling their first nighttime landing in 53 years. The crew, three NASA astronauts and one from Japan's space agency JAXA, spent almost 6 months in space. They flew back in SpaceX's Crew Dragon Resilience and splash landed off Panama City, Florida, yesterday morning South Africa time. There are still seven astronauts on the space station, including a new crew of four who, of course, arrived on a different SpaceX craft last week. This latest mission was a collaboration between NASA and SpaceX, a partnership that is going to be taking us to Mars. Now, Uganda has detected the Indian variant of the novel coronavirus, igniting fears that the East African nation could suffer a resurgence of cases just when its outbreak has waned. Pontiano Kalibu, head of the government-run Uganda Virus Research Institute, said the variant had been detected on a Ugandan who had returned from a visit to India. So far, Uganda, like many African countries, has experienced a relatively mild COVID-19 break. Next, highly endangered little creature born in the UK. It stands a mere 20 centimetres tall, has dark round button eyes and delicate soft pink pointed ears. It's a new residence in the Bristol Zoo in the United Kingdom. Now, many visitors ask whether it's a mouse, but it ain't. It's a mouse deer. Because mother mouse deer, Brienne, and proud papa mouse deer, Jora, have welcomed a new addition to their family. Now, proving the adage that good things come in very small packages, the bouncing baby Malaysian mouse deer fawn is the height of a standard pencil, and it's only the second of its species to be born at the Bristol Zoo in the past 10 years. Native to Southeast Asia, the mouse deer are the smallest hoofed animals in the world, and fully grown mouse deer weighs only about 1.3 kilograms. They're classed in the same category as pigs, sheep, giraffe, camels, and hippos. Paige Bwai of the Bristol Zoo said, and we quote, "Very few zoos care for any of the mouse deer species as they are so small in size, very secretive, and nocturnal. But it's vitally important that these wonderful little animals do not disappear for good. That is, if you can see them." Brilliant story to round off our news headlines. Let's get into the sport. Let's start with athletics, and what a message to send in an Olympic year. Sprinter Akane Simbine led Team South Africa to a gold medal win in the men's 4x100m relay event at the World Relays in Silesia, Poland last night. The 27-year-old Simbine anchored his team of Tando Dlodlo, Gift Leotlela and Clarence Munyai to the relay win in a time of 38.71 seconds. Very impressive performance. Then on to rugby, after scoring two tries in the last 14 minutes of the match, the Bulls recorded in the end a comfortable 24-9 victory over the Lions at Loftus-Versfeld. That was in their first Pro 14 Rainbow Cup fixture on Saturday. In the earlier match, the hat-trick by lock Ranil Hugo scoring a 33-30 win for the visiting Sharks over the Stormers at their new home in the Cape Town Stadium. That Rainbow Cup South Africa action will continue this weekend. Then staying with rugby, a last-minute try by CUT securing a stunning 23-18 win over the defending champions Marties at the Tuks Stadium in the Varsity Cup this weekend. Fullback Cohen Jasper scoring the match-winning try for CUT after an 18-all scoreline, really going down to the wire. And other results, UWC, they scored three second-half tries to beat UJ 31-5. NWU, they recorded a narrow 22-20 win over Wits, and Shimlers beat out the Madibas 24-20. And keeping it local for footballing news, reigning champions Mamelodi Sundowns reclaimed the top spot in the Premier Soccer League. That was after thrashing Orlando Pirates 3-0 at the Orlando Orlando Stadium. On Saturday, AmaZulu FC briefly went top of the log, edging out Golden Arrows in the Durban Derby 1-0. The Brazilians now currently top the table with 51 points. Osutu in second with just 50 points. Unbelievably close running at the end of the season. Now, other PSL results, Kaizer Chiefs and Bloem Celtic, they played out to a 2-2 draw. TX Galaxy kept their hopes of a top 8 finish alive, beating Cape Town City 1-0. And Maritzburg United and Swallows FC shared the spoils one apiece. Then, it's never happened before in the English Premier League. The clash between Manchester United and Liverpool was postponed due to protest action at Old Trafford. The Premier League said it was a collective decision by both clubs, police, the league and authorities to call off the fixture after about 200 fans were able to break into the stadium to protest against the Glazer family's ownership of the club. The discussions are in place to rearrange the game amidst a very bottlenecked season and run into the end of that season. So we'll watch that space very closely. And now we move on to the track. Seven-time Formula One world champion Lewis Hamilton, he fought back to win the Portuguese Grand Prix ahead of Red Bull's Max Verstappen and his Mercedes teammate Valtteri Bottas. This was the 36-year-old's 97th Grand Prix victory, an incredible feat. And the race win at the Algarve International Circuit now gives Hamilton an 8-point lead over Verstappen. Then on to two wheels, an emotional Jack Miller stormed victory at the Spanish Grand Prix in MotoGP yesterday. It was a 1-2 finish for Ducati after Miller cruised to his first race win in 5 years, and his Ducati teammate Francesco Bagnaia finished in second. Then Petronas Yamaha's Franco Morbidelli rounded off the podium positions in third. Unfortunately, South Africa's Brad Binder had probably his worst day on the track, not finishing the race after suffering two crashes. That's where we leave our sport for this hour. Let's get another look at some of your beautiful sunrise pictures.
Oh, and all those sunrise pictures are beautiful. Thank you very much to all those who did share their sunrise photos with us. We do love seeing how you start your day in your part of the country. Now, Fatah Khan shared this beautiful start to his day with a view of the harbour in Richards Bay. Serena Naika from Musgrave Art in Durban shared this stunning image overlooking the city, showing off this beautiful, colourful skyline filled with, as you can see, hues of oranges, blues and yellows. How stunning. Now, today, Durban can expect a pleasant day with a maximum of 24 degrees Celsius. And if you would like to see your sunrise photo feature on the show, all you need to do is go onto our Facebook page, Expresso Morning Show SABC3, and share that photo as well as your location. Now, we can't forget about our international viewers who are tuned in on the Africa channel as well as on YouTube. So we're going to give you a brief update on what weather to expect out in Kampala. That's the capital as well as largest city in Uganda. Kampala has a tropical rainforest climate with two annual wet seasons and does not have a true dry season month. Your Monday has occasional rain and a thunderstorm forecast for the morning, followed by thunderstorm in spots this afternoon. A warm day can still be expected with a max of 28 degrees. Now, the Nelson Mandela Bay Municipality has approved the construction of a seawater desalination plant. It's exciting. Now, this decision was taken at a special council meeting. It paves the way for the city's infrastructure and engineering director to enter into a partnership with the Kuga Development Corporation to proceed with plans to fast-track the project, considering, of course, the severity of the drought facing the city. Executive Mayor Ngaba Banga said that the decision showed a clear commitment by the municipality to invest in infrastructure that would secure major investments and improve the city's economy. Banga earlier said that the Nelson Mandela Bay Municipality was preparing for day zero and announced a water crisis plan in the event of taps running dry, which is expected to happen by the 1st of July. And now we take a look at your temperatures across the country. Starting off with Polokwane, your low today is 7, reaching a high of 20. If you're out in Mbombela today, 4% chance of rain. Your temperatures 10 and 24. Pretoria, the capital city, starting off at 8 today, reaching a high of 22, with Johannesburg, Josi Maboneng, at 7 and 20. If you're out in Mahikeng today, 6, that's your low, reaching a high of 23, with Klerksdorp starting off at 5, peaking at 20. Kimberley, 7 is your low, reaching highs of 23, with Bloemfontein out in the Free State, 3 and 22. Richards Bay, 14 and 23, with times of sun out in Pietermaritzburg today, 9 reaching a maximum of 23. If you are in South Africa's playground, Durban, 16 and 24, with Mthatha coming in at 7, that's your low, reaching a high of 25. East London, 14 and 25 maximum, Craddock, 7 and 26, with Gqeberha starting off at 14, peaking at 20. 25. George, 14 and 28 with the mother city, Cape Town. At 14, that's your minimum, reaching a max of 27. Wooster, 13 and 30 with Sutherland, starting off at 8, peaking at 21. If you're out in Upington, it's sunny times for you today. 12, that's your low, reaching a high of 28 degrees. Well, no matter what it's looking like in your part of the country, come on, go out there, make it a feel-good type of day. Jamie, what's happening?
Oh yes, Uncle Tabsy, things are certainly warming up in here because it's hashtag Woolies Mother's Day competition time. To start, we're giving a 1,000 Rand Woolworths gift card to one lucky winner.
Yeah, that moment of truth has arrived, so can I get a big congratulations for Tombomzi Mbeteni Umamthande. Yes! Now listen to this heartwarming Mother's Day message, which we absolutely loved. It says, Mother's Day won't be the same for the first time without you, Mommy dearest. Now, it brings back memories that are absolutely unforgettable, and thank you for your prayers, protection, and kindness. Your love for us was constant, your devotion had no end, and you filled our life with sunshine and with those jokes as a mother and a friend. So may you know forever that to us, you were the best mom. Happy Mother's Day, Mommy dearest, and that's with love for his belated mom over there. So
that is beautiful.
Massive condolences, but at the same time, I think this prize could not go to more of a deserved winner. And a big congratulations.
Getting indeed all the feels with that message. But yes, like Ral said, sending you all that love. But of course, for you at home, you still stand the chance to win a 1,000 Rand Woolworths gift card of your own. All you have to do is share your personal Mother's Day message on our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram competition posts with the hashtag Woolies Mother's Day. Now, remember that the competition closes at 9 a.m. today. Yes, today. And those T's and C's can be found on our website, which is expressoshow.com. So happy entering to all of you.
It's my feel-good breakfast show.
Welcome back, you gorgeous people. You're just in time for your dose of feel-good this morning. It is Expresso Live here on S3. Of course, we're starting a brand new day. We love to see all those stunning sunrise photos. And here's the thing. Sunrise looks spectacular in nature, in photos, in dreams, and in paintings. Because it really is spectacular. And this is a quote by guess who?
Who is it?
Can I guess? Not Nelson Mandela. Come on, Ryle.
Mahatma Gandhi?
not Mahatma Gandhi, but it was by Mehmet Murat Yildan. Okay. And of course, if there's one thing all your hashtag Nespresso sunrise pictures have shown us, it really is that we do live in a beautiful country. Magnificent skies everywhere you look. Now, your pictures are outstanding, but there can only be one winner for the best sunrise shot. Ladies and gents, drum roll, please. And the winner is...
Rika
Come on!
We're in the building, man. Thank you so much for sending in your remarkable sunrise picture. Are you with us? I believe you tuned in.
Good morning. Yes, I'm in.
Good morning, man. You're looking fresh, you're looking good, you're glowing. It must be the fact that you get to absorb all those beautiful sunrises, yeah?
Yeah, you got to get up early to get them, man. Definitely.
Well, here's the thing, is now you've won yourself that stylish Nespresso travel mug. I can tell you very much are the outdoorsy type of guy. Are you always out and about hiking and taking your coffee with you as you go?
Well, I love my hikes. I love my hikes. Hikes are, that's my go-to exercise and get out there, get outdoors and everything, yeah? Get very fresh air. And I think it's more than just the hike. It's more about the story about around the hike, you know, going out with some friends and spending the time out there, the chats and everything around that. It's even the sunrise. It's not really the sunrise. It's more the story behind it.
Man, I'm looking at these pictures of you and your mates exploring and just absorbing all the magic we've got in our country. So you're definitely my kind of person, man. But where, especially for this picture that you took, where, when was this? Was it? Is it real? It looks like a dream. What's going on here? Take me through it.
This photo is from Lion's Head. We did a sunrise hike earlier this year, I think around Jan time. And we did a sunrise hike, and that was the photo.
I like what you said now, saying that it's not just a sunrise. It's a moment that you're capturing as part of a bigger experience. Mm. What is it about sunrise pictures that you love so much, Amin?
I don't know. It's something about that old melting pot that draws you in. It's that peace. And it's that time of morning also when you hear the birds chirping and you're out at the beach or something, you hear the waves crashing. And you sort of miss that if you wake up any later and all the cars start moving around, people start going out and about. And it's just something about that time of the morning.
I think what Tubbs is asking is a very difficult question, if I can relate to you. I mean, it's so difficult to express the magic of the outdoors. But what I can see is that you definitely are someone that has tasted that magic. And this is how I explain it, because I see people that come from beautiful spaces like you do, and you've got this look on your face. You've got this, like, smirk that, like, nah, man, I'm good. I'm fueled, like, proper. You're not going to shake this mood right now, man. So I love that look.
But here's the thing, right? And a big part of this show, as you know, is that we live on coffee, right?
Yeah.
You have now won this Nespresso travel mug. You've got to be sharing your coffee with someone. Who are you going to be sharing your first coffee in the travel mug with?
Yeah, it's definitely my buddy. I think you guys saw the photo there, Tiana over there, and he's always inviting me out for hikes, like me, outdoor kind of soul. Always out there, you know, let's go for a hike, whatever. Send me a message like 11 o'clock tonight. I'm going to go for a hike tomorrow morning, and I'll be like, it's a late notice, but I'm keen, you know?
Sweet, man.
Yeah.
I love the bromance. Love it.
Yeah, I love it, man. And here's to many more adventures. Obviously, we kind of filled you with something that can make it that much more special. And hopefully, you can share some of the magic in your new Nespresso travel mug. Yeah. And thank you, Muin. Thank you so much for sharing.
Really appreciate it.
Yeah, man. Keep sending those pictures in. I think for a lot of us here in Mzansi, we don't always get the opportunity to travel. So we vicariously live through people like you. So keep sending it through, man.
It's a pleasure, man. It's a pleasure.
Ah, congratulations. We love putting a smile on people's faces at this time of the morning. We can't get enough of your beautiful pictures as well. So please keep sharing those. Use that hashtag Nespresso Sunrise Snaps, and you could win, of course, these stunning Nespresso travel mugs in style, man. Come on.
With every cup, we cultivate some of the finest coffee in the world, celebrating farmers as artists, elevating every coffee moment, because with every cup, precious coffee preserves the beauty of our world. Nespresso, what else?
And of course, from appreciating the views in the sky to soaring off to Mars, we're now focusing on NASA's Ingenuity taking a flight right now.
The Perseverance mission on Mars has yet again proven to be a success. They are racking them up with NASA's Ingenuity helicopter that was on the craft, now having just become the first vehicle to successfully take flight on another planet. This is big. It is awesome. Science engagement astronomer from the observatory, Dr. Daniel Kadima, now joins us to tell us a little bit more. Dr. Dan, this is awesome. A historic moment for science, for space exploration, for NASA. We know that rovers have been sent to Mars before, but none that could give us an aerial visualization. This really is a milestone.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's pretty insane to think that we firstly, the landing of the rover was incredible. We have done that before, but to pull it all off, and then for this little helicopter to sit underneath the rover you know, the rover drove off, let it sort of charge up its batteries in the sun, and then take flight. It's truly remarkable. I mean, the fact that we're even attempting such things is incredible.
The first step, I would imagine, in a very big rollout plan. But just so we can get into why people are making such a stir around this, Mars, with its atmosphere, is obviously a very difficult place to fly objects. Why is that?
Yeah, so the main thing really is that the atmosphere on Mars is very thin. So it's about 1% of the atmosphere on the Earth. So there's not a lot of air to push your wings down on. So the helicopter has to be very light. It's just under 2 kgs, and it has very fast rotors to try and get enough lift to take it off the ground. The other thing which is important and difficult is that the craft has to be completely autonomous, because it's such a small vehicle that can't communicate directly to Earth. Even if it could, it would take a matter of quite a few minutes before we could sort of get a signal and then tell it what to do
and
next.
Bounce it back, yeah.
So it has to fly all by itself. It has to figure out, you know, where it's going, what's underneath it, and where to land. And it has to do that like on the fly by itself. Excuse the pun.
It really is amazing, and it's the start of something amazing. I'm sure that they've got big plans for this little guy. Week one, have we gleaned anything from what it's been able to achieve and seen? How much did it actually do in its first flight? I would imagine just a small one. And what's next for it?
Yeah, so there'll be a series of test flights. The first couple are just to sort of see, you know, that it can do everything. It can go up and down, can land, can move left and right. And then it can obviously charge its solar panels and things. It's probably only got a month of life. Maybe a little bit more. So they'll keep pushing it further away to look further and do more sort of dangerous maneuvers until one of them isn't going to go well, and that'll be the end of it. This is a proof of concept. They want to do as much as they can in a very short period. They don't expect it to last very long. So I'm trying very hard not to get too attached to it.
It's too late, man. You've forced me to get an emotional attachment and investment in this little guy. But I like the idea of go big or go home, man. It's Top Gun vibes. It's like, you know, he's going to do something special. What are they hoping that this little guy is going to see?
Yeah, so the rover itself, Perseverance, can only travel, you know, quite a short distance a day, 20 meters or so. And it doesn't really know what's around it other than what it can see. So what the helicopter can do is it can fly up, and it can fly quite far away. It can fly up to like 300 meters away, which is days or weeks of travel for the rover. So it can go off, it can find out exactly what's around. And if it sees interesting objects and things, then we can direct the rover that direction and go and explore in more detail. So it basically can cover a large area of Mars in quite a short period of time, kind of map that for us and plan the next year worth of missions for the rover.
Why is Mars so appealing to us as the human race? What is it about this planet that makes it such a source of science focus?
So I think there's a couple of things. Firstly, it's the closest planet to Earth in terms of similarity, you know, in terms of something which could sustain life. We've learned over the last couple of decades that Mars definitely had running water at some point in its history. But that means that it's the most likely place for life to have formed and evolved. If we can discover signs of past life on Mars, it changes our whole view of the universe in terms of what life can do and where it can form. If it formed independently on two different planets right next door to each other, I mean, it must
game
be
on.
Everywhere, right?
Yeah, game on. I like the sound of that. And I think that there is this kind of impending holding of breath, this kind of feeling that we are going to discover something. There is going to be something big there. But on a very practical level, we're also seeing this as a place that we can habitate. And what sets Mars apart from other planets that kind of makes it a habitable planet, something that we are planning to actually send people to go and live there?
Once again, the water is a big factor. So there's still water on Mars. It's not in liquid state anymore, but there's a lot of ice on Mars, which means that we could survive on Mars. You know, one of the primary things we need is water. Life needs water. If we want to grow potatoes like Matt Damon, then we need some water. It's got a decent gravity similar to our own. It is a sort of nearest habitable planet. The moon, we could put a lunar base on there, but there's not a lot of water on the moon. It's got very low gravity. It's not the most exciting place to be. Whereas Mars really could sustain a base for years and decades, but potentially permanently.
Potentially permanently, and I have no doubt that we're going to get there, and it's going to be happening in our lifetime, which is even more amazing. Well, buddy, I'm both enthused and greatly saddened by our discussion this morning, so thank you so much for letting me know that this little guy, the Ingenuity helicopter, the lifespan is not as long as I hoped it would be, but I have no doubt that it's going to tell us some incredible things about the red planet and, as you say, aid in the next phase of exploration. I'm just rueing that day when we've got to hear about Ingenuity's crashing on the surface. But let's cross our fingers. Let's hope that doesn't come sooner rather than later. Buddy, as always, an absolute pleasure. Thank you for inspiring us and filling our head with these amazing thoughts of where humanity is going. I think Mars is becoming more and more of kind of that next frontier for us, which is so exciting. So thank you so much, my man.
Thank you. Thanks again for having me.
It's my feel-good breakfast show. Welcome back, everybody. You're still opening up with S3 on your Feel Good Breakfast Show. It is time for some fun and games on your Feel Good Breakfast Show because Stacy Francis will be joining us for a round of one of our favorite games, Music Match, everybody. Now, here's how it works. I will give our players a word and they need to sing an existing keyword, existing song that features that word in the lyrics.
Right.
Yeah. Or you can write it.
Existing, so you can't write it on the
okay,
spot.
Okay, okay,
other
okay.
Other words, Stacey, okay?
Of course, you guys at home, we will see how well you do, okay? So, again, it has to be an existing word, Mr. Tabi. So, my money's on you, Stacey. We okay. Hope you do a bit of a
okay,
move
got
up
you.
Now.
Oh, I got
come
you.
On,
girl,
Stacey.
Girl, 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 rule the world. We
come
got
on.
You rule the world.
Jamie,
yes.
Loyalty, no?
I love you.
Okay.
But I know.
All right.
I know.
Okay. All right. All right.
I'm going to start with you, Uncle Tabs, just to get our guess a bit
thank
more.
Thank you for that.
First word is free.
Now that I'm free, I find myself.
Well done, Uncle.
I'm doing better without you. Come on.
Okay.
Good
job.
Setting the pace.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes. Your word is together.
Oh, well, we said I couldn't sing an original song, but I'm singing this later. Stand together. Not a single one of us is going to stop because we're standing together forever. Ooh. Not a single one of us is going to stop because we're standing alive. That's it.
Wow. Okay, well, okay. I have to up
it
my game.
That was my song.
How do I even
I
top
it.
That?
Child can sing.
Wow.
Do you want to leave now or later?
I'll stay.
Please stay, Uncle Tabs.
Okay.
Your word is good.
Can I jump in or no? Okay. Don't save him.
5.
Now you've put on quite a show. I'm trying to match your really had me going. That was a good show. Really entertaining. But it's over now.
Is that one now? Confess your backup singer because that was not the lyrics. Yeah.
That's not the lyrics. You just did.
You butchered that.
You put good in
I must
you
say, I did. I did actually just change
so
one of the words.
Okay,
and
you
I did just add good there. Okay.
Stacy, I'm coming back to you.
Okay, okay. What we got?
Your word is fire.
Ooh. Ooh.
To the fire. Do wow. Whatever. Come what may. For Stacy.
Glasses, break it.
I think that's it. Chocolate,
wow.
Right?
Okay.
Yeah.
It's fine. I'll catch you later. I'll catch you later. I'm out of here.
Come on, you guys. Come on, come on, come on.
Luckily, they
don't give up. Don't give up.
Don't give up.
Okay.
You still have a chance. Your word is somebody.
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 Somebody sleeping in my bed.
With that voice, nobody is sleeping in your bed, I shall tell
you. Oh, wow. But that's an actual song, right?
It is, right?
It's not about the voice, it's about the song.
Thank the Lord.
I think that is the right lyric. Okay. Yes. Okay.
We'll give it to him.
Okay, okay.
We'll feel sad for him. Stacy, your word is mirror.
Mirror? Oh, I might fail on this one. Mirror.
I'm starting with.
Oh, you're right. Come on, thank you.
No,
for that
I want to get.
I'm starting with the man in the mirror.
Come on, y'all. Yeah.
I'm asking him to change his way.
I said, oh, yeah.
No message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place,
take a look at yourself and then make a change.
Woo. Yes. Na 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 na.
Sing it.
Yes. Yes.
You're a good backup singer.
I love it. Thanks
yes,
for,
that's
thanks
why
for
I'm
me
here.
A clue. That was very sweet. That was very sweet.
Back to you. Your word is fly.
Fly?
Fly.
Oh, I have a good one for you. You want me to give you a tip since you can? I believe I can fly.
Fly away. Fly away, my heart. Don't you cry.
I don't know that
the
song.
The world is...
Is that a song?
In your hands. You smile, you cry, and you dance.
Is that an actual song?
It
yes.
is.
Okay.
It's from Judas Puma. The words does not go like that. Again, we just apologize to Judas Puma.
Come on.
We're watching right now.
But you get the gist
we
of it.
We love you. We do love you. What do we get? He's not going to give it to you. Back to you, Stacy. Your word is night.
Night.
Ooh,
Silent night.
I don't know. Can
silent
you help me?
Silent night.
Oh, silent night. Holy night. All is calm. All is bright.
Oh, my word. Oh,
I'm silent after that. I think
damn.
It's so weird when you're put on the spot. Of course you know these words, right? But
you
it's
do.
Just like so weird.
I think we
need to find out who the winner is. Let me just calculate.
I think it's a tie.
It is certainly not a tie. The winner, ladies and gentlemen, Stacy Frank. Yeah,
and the voice of an angel.
Thank you
as
so
well.
Much. Wow. I've been up since 4 o'clock. I was warming up at 4 o'clock trying to get it together.
Well listen, everybody, Stacy Francis is not going anywhere. She still has 3 amazing performances coming your way on your Feel Good Breakfast show, so don't go anywhere.
Yeah, sing it, sing it.
So much fun in the studio now. Jenny's with me this morning, and I'm going to be asking her if she's going to be able to make me a recipe that we can maybe use to help me sing and hit a note like Stacy. I'm trying. You guys figure out if it'll do the job. Let's figure it out.
Made with love by Clover.
Ah, let's breathe. Wow, that was a lot. That was a jewel. Wow. But now, if you are looking for something delicious, it's a meat-free meal. It's all the inspiration you need to help mom have a weeknight off, especially considering that Mother's Day is around the corner. Then this foolproof mushroom stroganoff recipe is just what you need. And of course, as promised, Jenny Morris in the building to show us how it's done. I like that. Wow, I don't think any of us could ever reach those notes that Stacy did, but when it comes to tasting notes, we can try our
best. Hello, darling. I hit all those notes when it comes to taste.
Yeah, for it.
So what's happening is stroganoff. It's something I haven't eaten often. Mushrooms.
I love it. You can use all kinds of mushrooms. What I've done is I've put some beautiful sliced onions into the pan, and I'm wetting them down, which means I'm just sort of wilting them, caramelizing them, getting all that deliciousness. Look at that. You're getting all that lovely natural sugar released.
Did you start with the onions first?
Always first, because you want them to do a little number on you and release nicely. I'm going to add some salt and pepper to this, and I'm going to add some garlic, because stroganoff without a garlic is no good. Salt is going to release this beautiful natural mushroom stock that is in here, but I'm going to need lots of stock.
So you are going to get some stock and sort of flavor from those mushrooms.
Oh yes, nothing gets lost here. It's all in the pan, and that's where it stays.
Beautiful.
Can you smell that? It's already that earthiness is starting to come off it.
It's the kind of thing that I almost recognize, and I know it's very basic at the moment, but something I recognize and something I definitely invite on a burger. That little onion relish with butter.
Absolutely.
So what are we? What do you need?
Let's start with the spices. Give me the paprika.
Paprika.
You can pack them there, my sweetheart. Right. So in with the paprika. And this reminds me of stroganoff all along the Danube, you know. They all have their own little version of it.
Yeah.
Oh, can you smell that?
I am smelling that now. That was actually just a perfect little combination to that. What was already smelling good, that paprika is kind of just giving that the spice you need in your life.
All the different notes, Doc.
Yes.
All the different notes. So now I want to, because once the spice has come up off the pan, you know that it's ready to receive.
What is that, orange juice?
Darling, you wish it was orange juice. This is beautiful vegetable stock.
Like the good stuff, the umami, the loving when it comes to a meal,
And you hit the nail on the head by saying umami, because mushrooms are so full of umami.
Ooh.
Lovely. Okay. I'm going to add, first of all, my sour cream and get that to reduce nicely. And what's nice about the mustard is I normally just stir it in at the end so that it just keeps that beautiful, vibrant, mushroomy flavor. Mm. Look at that. This is gorgeous on pasta.
So this is
going
to get it
noodles.
To, like, kind of cream up now,
Look at it. It's waiting for your little happy mouth to taste it. Look here, darling.
So I'm wiping my mouth constantly.
Yes.
Sorry for drooling here, Mzanzi, but I can't help it.
And, I mean, if you don't want to use a Dijon mustard, you could use any mustard. It's such a lovely, versatile dish. Look at that.
Yeah.
This is very happy. And last but not least, darling, we're going to just sprinkle in all of our parsley, full of vitamin C. Deliciousness.
All right.
You're going to want this with some pasta, hey?
I am going to want it. But you know what, Jenny, to be honest with you, like, I get spoiled by you so often. So I'm thinking that this looks good enough to even serve to our VIP.
I will make her sing for her supper. I think so.
So, are you done? Is this it?
That's it, darling.
Simple as that, Mzanzi. Well,
and easy.
Look, let me not put the proof in the pudding. She's the one when it comes to mastering notes. She does it all in singing. But let's see if she can approve of these notes being mastered in the kitchen. So, Stacy, all you want to come through over here for us. And Jenny Morris is what is
she
when it comes to
here?
Notes? Yeah, you can stand right over here. So, she kills the notes
so
in the kitchen.
Delicious.
You kill the notes on the mic.
That's very
sweet. So, this is like a note collaboration and a half. So let's see what these powerful women can get up to. And let us know honestly what you think of
this. Okay, I totally will.
We have tough skin, both Jenny and I, so you can be honest.
No, I will. I'll be honest.
Don't you dare.
Are you saying... That's so funny. It's like we looked at each other like, okay, it's okay if I'm honest. Just like, no.
If you didn't see that close-up,
so
as Jenny said it, Stacey was like,
no, I'll be honest.
I'm all about the best.
Well, let me tell you something. I have an Italian man at home that cooks for me all the time, so I'll be able to tell you.
Well, this is not from Italy, so I'm in safe water.
You're safe.
That's true.
It smells good, I can tell you that much.
Is it good?
It's delicious.
Oh, I'm so happy to hear it.
No, it really,
so
really
honest.
Is. It is. Yes, and I need a little pasta before I sing. You know, singers like
that. Oh, yes. Well, there you go, Mzansi. If Stacy approves, the international approves, then you know we've got it covered here. And you can get this recipe inspiration online. You go to expresso.com. And if you just tuned in and you missed all this magic, shame on you. But don't worry, Mzansi, we got you covered. Check this out.
It's my feel-good breakfast show. Welcome back, everybody. You're still opening up with S3E on your feel-good breakfast show. Happy Monday, but you are still in for a treat because we still have Stacy Francis with us, and not only is she sharing her phenomenal talents with the world, she throws herself into her genuine passion to give back in communities both where she's from and right here in Cape Town through the Stacy Francis Music, Art and Education Foundation. She has joined forces with Elna Primary School teacher Craig Nadelman to feed the community in Alsace River, and they're both on the couch to share more about this. Girl, you are a powerhouse. You do everything you sing, and now to give back to the community. That is amazing.
Yeah, and of course, really interesting.
And joined by Craig Nadelman from the foundation as well. And I can see how proud he is of this union.
Yeah.
It's difficult for me to know where to begin because there are layers here. First of all, you're amazing.
Thank you.
Just such a wonderful human being.
Thank you so much.
To have on our set. That's just from the second I walked into studio, I could just feel that energy. So thank you for being that for us today.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
But this connection to South Africa and taking it this step forward, I know you have a fan base here.
Yeah.
But why this love and passion for this country, for Alsace River especially? And you know, Alsace is standing up right now going, yeah. What the emotional connection, why is this so important to you?
Well, it's interesting because I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, in a lower income area. And I found as an African-American woman that I've traveled so much, as we talked about earlier, and the connection between poverty, it's Africa, it's America, it's the
global,
same, right?
Yeah.
It's global, it's not. So the problems that we have as far as a food deficit in Alsace River is honestly a food deficit in Brooklyn, and it's a food desert where I come from. So I fed 30,000 meals there last summer, and over the last 2 years, we've done about 70 or 80,000 meals. This last week, we did almost upwards of 3,000 meals. And it's interesting, I had a fan who saw me on the X Factor, who created 30 Twitter pages for me and was voting for me to keep me on the show. And he's actually a teacher at the school.
And Dylan,
that's right, Dylan Henwood. And he's a teacher at the school, and I came to visit him at the school, and I saw the conditions of the school, and I said, you know, we have to do something about this. And I encouraged Dylan to make it a group problem, you know, make it a community, make the teachers, which are incredible, all the teachers at Elnor are incredible. They repainted the school, they fundraised, they repainted the school. I mean, the way that they've come together as a group, and I want to say this to teachers out there and schools out there, reach out to us, because we really want to help not just this school, but every school that we can in South Africa. We really want to really, really do our best, because honestly, it's a community problem. It's not just,
socioeconomic.
Exactly.
I think what those teachers and those headmasters, you know, we've got some of the best pass rates in the country happening in the Western Cape, despite those conditions. So those educators are doing it.
They're incredible. They're incredible.
And Dylan, you obviously...
No, this is Craig.
You obviously came in, you know Stacy for about 15 years, and then you got connected to this.
Totally.
Tell us about your part in this.
I've known Stacy for about 15 years. She's been a good friend of mine. But she really is such an inspiration. You know, the way she brings the groups together just to do what she does, she's amazing. And the fundamentals at the moment in the schools is that the food scheme is still an issue.
Yeah.
You know, the food scheme is a big problem. The kids still need food. Mm. The basic essentials are still a problem. They need toiletries.
Yeah.
And, you know, the way that Stacy just got rallied everyone together, I just had to get behind that.
Thank you. And, you know, while we're here, I think it's ShopRite. The ShopRites, you know the stores better than me.
Pick and Pay, ShopRite, Checkers.
We want to talk to those people about actually coming in and helping us with the food, because every time there's a break during the school year, which is about 4 or 5 times a year, our nonprofit steps in to feed the kids. And so it's always a food problem. So if we could get one of those companies to come on board and feed the school, we also need a kitchen. We are serving outside of a container 500 meals.
500 plus meals.
500 plus meals. That the cook is cooking the food in this little container. So we're looking to fundraise for a kitchen. And it's just, you know, it's fundamentals that we really, really need for the school right now.
We've seen it over the last year. The number of food insecure people in South Africa has doubled over lockdown.
Right.
Unbelievably hard hit.
Right.
And there's this new environment of previously used to jump through so many hoops to get your corporate social responsibility investment on board and get these. But now people are just doing it.
Yep.
People like yourself are stepping up and just doing it.
Yes.
What do you need and what do you want to say to those parties that can step up? Why should they support your foundation?
Well, I'm going to tell you something. I've been in America. A lot of my efforts were in America, like helping Dylan fundraise and helping the school. The principal is incredible. Every time I say to him, can we do this project? He says, yes. You know, we put the teachers through a training program. I want to take a moment to thank Flash Academy and Yuron Shapiro for helping me train the teachers a course learning how to learn, because I heard that there were 17-year-olds in the school that didn't read. So there's all these different elements of things that we need, right? But like I was saying, the basics of what we need right now, we need ShopRite, we need Pick and Pay. We need these big corporations like that to really, really get behind us and help us with the food problem, because the food is, if a child is hungry, they can't learn. They can't even focus, right? They come to...
Well, their brains can't grow.
No, they can't. And I'm going to tell you, when I was on the ground last week, actually handing a child a meal is different than being on the phone fundraising. It's different than a corporation. Oh my God, it gets so real. I was in tears when a mom walked up to me, and the rule per the principal is that all the children are supposed to get a meal before the adults. And so you have like a really long line of adults waiting for the kids to come. So this mom walked up to me and she had a baby, and I'm getting teary now. She had a baby and she said, my baby would like a meal. And I said, okay. And she said, can I have one too? And I had to turn her away because the principal made a rule about that. And I said, please give her a meal. This is a mom. And that's when it hit me. Look, we're not just talking about food now. We're talking about women's health care. We're talking about daycare. We're talking about, I mean, it's
basic
all these
human rights,
basic human rights, you know?
Exactly.
And so that's what I'm really passionate about. My nonprofit is, I'm passionate about making those changes. And I want to emphasize again the fact that these teachers and the principal, all the staff coming together and allowing us to come in and work together as a group, is no one person can do it by themselves. Mm-hmm. I can't do it by myself. Dylan can't do it by himself. The principal can't do it. The community comes together, and the work that we're doing makes it, it's just so miraculous to see it. And I want to push those corporations to please come in and help us.
Well, here's the thing. I want you to take all of that emotion.
Yeah.
And I want you to
Okay. Well, let me before I go, just I want you guys, it's the StacyFrancisFoundation.com. Donations, you can click donations and give a donation, and the money goes to those meals and to whatever is needed at the school. And so I'm gonna sing Imagine right now.
Okay, well you can go and do that.
Imagine right now.
Just imagine. I'm going to round off now quickly with you, Craig. Do you think we are seeing the right kind of shift that we need? What is it going to take to get us across the line from someone who's working on the front lines?
Well, look, I think the seg also between USA and SA, the way that that gap's been bridged and what Stacey's done to bridge that gap is amazing. You know, you can actually start to feel that and see that. But I think what Stacey said, everyone needs to actually pull up their sleeves, dig in, get your hands dirty. Whatever you can do, if you've got food, bring it to the school. We need it. If you've got toiletries, bring it to the school. I know there's a lot of people that need help.
Yeah.
But you pointed out the socioeconomic issues is a huge, huge problem.
Probably our biggest.
The literacy initiative is a massive problem. So if you've got any ability to help, we need it. And we want to help you. So it is it's a community effort. So please, come and help us.
Oh, if you're a school, if you're a headmaster, if you're a teacher, reach out for help. And most importantly, if you've got something to give, now is the time to step up. And let's see if this might motivate you. Stacy Francis is taking the Expresso stage right now to perform a John Lennon absolute classic. His one of his best-selling singles, undoubtedly, from his solo career. This is Imagine.
People living for
Welcome back, everybody. Still opening up with SV. Imagine you can sing like that. Stacy Francis is still here with two more performances on your Feel Good Breakfast show, so you don't want to go anywhere.
And right up, of course, we've got G sending it through with the news, and then the magic continues. Check it out.
Coming to you just a touch early, 2 minutes before the top of the hour. Let's delve into our national news first. There are two High Court cases related to the will and estate of King Goodwill Zwelithini, who of course passed away in March. One concerns his will and the other concerns his estate and his successor. His two daughters by his first wife, Sibongile Dlamini, question the authenticity of their father's signature on his will. Moreover, their mother requests that the Supreme Court recognizes her civil marriage to Zwelithini as the only binding contract. Zwelithini's third wife, Mfombe Dlamini Zuma, died on Thursday from unknown causes. She was appointed to act in his place for 3 months. And staying in South Africa, Forestry, Fisheries and Environment Minister Barbara Creasy yesterday released a long-awaited high-level panel report on the management, breeding, hunting, trade and handling of elephant, lion, leopard and rhinoceros. Now, the report noted that captive lion breeding damaged South Africa's reputation abroad. A majority of stakeholders supported ending domestication of the country's lions by outlawing breeding and commercial use of the big cats. Big step and marker laid down. The panel recommends that South Africa does not captive breed lions, that they don't keep lions in captivity or use captive lions commercially. Now, on the international front, a senior Muslim cleric in the Democratic Republic of Congo has been shot dead while praying in the main mosque in Beni City. The gunman shot Sheikh Al-Amini during evening prayers on Saturday and then fled. He escaped with an accomplice on a motorbike. The cleric was a strong critic of Islamic militancy in the region. The imam's killing during the Muslim holy month of Ramadan has obviously caused a great deal of shock in Beni and across the globe. And Beni is a city with a population of some 200,000 residents. Then now going off planet, four astronauts have returned to the Earth from the International Space Station in what NASA's first nighttime landing in 53 years went as a success. The crew, three NASA astronauts and one from Japan's space agency JAXA, spent almost 6 months in space. They flew back in SpaceX's Crew Dragon Resilience and then splash landed off Panama City, Florida yesterday morning, South Africa time. There are still seven astronauts on the space station, including a new crew of four who arrived on a different SpaceX craft last week. This is the latest mission that is a collaboration between NASA and SpaceX. I think we are seeing that as the official partnership to take us to Mars. Next, a story that will inspire you. A space shuttle liftoff inspiring a young boy to reach for the stars. So from the dusty streets of Katlehong in Kurileni, Gauteng, a young boy watched in 1981 as the space shuttle Columbia STS-1 took off until it was just a tiny speck of dust in the sky. Well, this event inspired Zeblon Zanele Vilakazi, or Zanele Vilakazi, who was born there on the 3rd of April in 1969, to reach for the stars, literally. Last week, some 40 years later, this nuclear physicist was officially installed as the 16th Vice Chancellor and Principal of Wits University, rated as Africa's second best university. And he said, and we quote, "You do not usher in a vision in a moment of euphoria. You do it because the vision you are articulating is as important as the other challenges, which must be." The youngest of a family of eight whose father ran a small shop in the community, he was one of the first students from Africa to conduct PhD research at the European Centre for Nuclear Research in Geneva in Switzerland. And just to add to it, Vilakazi is also fluent in seven languages: French, German, Zulu, Seswati, Sesotho, Afrikaans and English. And he was hooded by Wits's Chancellor, Dr. Judy Dlamini, and we certainly tip our hats to him. Well, that's where we leave our headlines for now. Let's get one last look at some of your beautiful sunrise pictures and a take on our Monday morning weather.
Thank you very much, G-Man. We take a final look at your sunrise pictures. Thank you very much to everyone that did send their sunrise views with us. We love seeing how you start your day. We started with Carmen Murray Martin from Richards Bay with her view of the lake. How stunning. We also received this stunning image of the colourful sky from international viewer Shemaine Blackburn from Kalgoorlie out in Australia. At 7 a.m., Fatakan shared this beautiful start to his day with a view of the harbour in Richards Bay. And last but not least, Serena Necker from Musgrave Art in Durban shared this stunning image overlooking the city, showing off a colourful skyline filled with hues of oranges, blues and yellows. Now, if you'd like to be featured during one of our sunrise segments, please, it's really simple. Listen to this. Go onto our Facebook page, Expresso Morning Show SABC3, and you could possibly see your photo during one of our weather updates. Now, for our last international city feature this morning, we give a shout out to any viewers tuned in from Tucson, Arizona. Now, Tucson has a hot semi-arid climate, or Tucson rather, with two major seasons and a hot summer and mild winter. Summer is characterized with daytime temperatures of over 38 degrees Celsius, and the area is an adventurous dream with plenty of space for mountain biking and canyons, as well as desert lands to explore. Today, you can expect plenty of sunshine with a maximum of 29 degrees. Now, exciting space news is that NASA has announced that it is extending its Mars helicopter mission. NASA said that the first three flights of the chopper called Ingenuity had worked so well, it would now be moving from a demonstration to an operational phase. This means that the chopper will support NASA's Perseverance rover, helping with its hunt for signs of life. How exciting. Now, the new phase will last for another 30 Martian days, but the team said it was hopeful the operational role could be extended further. Now, Ingenuity will now be helping out with the rover's science program. It will work with the Perseverance robot as it starts to investigate Jezero Crater, a region of Mars that was once a lake, collecting rock samples that it can study with its onboard instruments and tools. It will also fly up to a kilometer ahead of the rover, scouting for promising geological features and exploring areas that Perseverance cannot reach, making digital elevation maps to help scientists to better understand the terrain. Now, the ultimate aim is to find signs of life. It could be really, really interesting. Now, a final look at those temperatures across the country. Bulawayo, a low of 7, reaching a maximum of 20, with Mbombela sunny times. 4% chance of rain out there, 10, reaching a high of 24. If you're out in the capital city, Pretoria, 8 is your low, reaching a high of 22. With times of sun and clouds for Johannesburg at 7, your low reaching highs of 20. Mahikeng, 6 and 23. Klerksdorp, you're coming in at 5 minimum, reaching a maximum of 23. Kimberley, 7 and 23, with a 1% chance of rain out in Bloemfontein. Sunny times, 3 and 22. Times of sun and clouds for Richards Bay, 14, that's your low, reaching a high of 23. With Pietermaritzburg at 9, reaching a max of 23. Durban, 16, peaking at 24, with Mthatha at 7, that's your low, reaching a high of 25. East London, 14, and you will peak at 25. If you're out in Craddock, your low today is 7, reaching a high of 26, with Gqeberha at 14 and 25. George, 14, that's your low, you will peak at 28 degrees. Cape Town, 14 and 27, with Worcester at 13, reaching a high of 30. Sutherland, 8 and 21. And lastly, it's sunny out in Upington today, 12, reaching a high of 28. And that's where we leave it for this morning. What's happening on social media, Tim?
Yes, Mr. Tabs, a lot is happening on the social media field. We asked you today, if you had to pack three things to take with you to Mars, what would it be? And I'm very interested to see what you, the viewers at home, had to say about this question. So let's take a look.
Let's see what Lesego S. Lekelebane says. It's my cam, I'm assuming camera, food and water. Surprisingly, I think there's frozen water on Mars. So if you just took like some flames,
you could.
Yeah, I think. But I like that one. Yeah. Let's see. Jean Singh says, Expresso show. I don't. You can't take us with. I wish you could, because that would probably be all you need. But definitely water, food, and medication.
That is interesting. Eugene Duval says, a bottle of air. Myself and preloaded Expresso show on my phone.
Hang on.
Eugene, you are the person.
But Eugene, what happens when your bottle runs out, bruh?
And then you'll have to have Mars air. And
take
also,
a case.
What is your battery on your phone? Anyway, we're getting too technical with this one. Gareth Michael says, but if we could leave here, I would take water, food, and plenty of seeds to plant.
Yeah,
just like you, seeds. A lot of seeds. Everybody wants to take some seeds.
I didn't ask you this morning, and I'm dying to know, Jamie Lee Dunberg, what would you take?
My son.
Obviously.
I just want to take him off the experience. My mom, that's a 2-for-1 package. My phone again. But not to take snapshots, just to like take a picture and then drop it down and then somehow it falls onto Earth. And then I don't know.
You're just gonna chuck. Hey,
just wait.
Peter, you're out.
Peter.
Just chuck it.
From there, like, boom, tish, and that is it. And then also preloaded shows of Expresso just to entertain me because
I like look that. Back at I like that. Like... I like some of your answers as well, Zanzi. Thank you for coming in and letting us know, of course. I think the winners were definitely the ones that took Expresso show with. Oh, you guys are the best.
So cute.
Take some money.
Would you need money on Mars? Do you trade in Mars rock?
Yeah.
What do? You probably trade in food, I would imagine. You trade in food and water.
That would be a bit of a rare commodity.
But time to talk a little bit of money. So we've been posing some really interesting questions. A few would you rather conundrums that got everyone, including us, very much debating what we would do. So this morning we want to go through each of the questions that we put to you guys and see what the official popular opinions on social media, the truth of it.
Yeah, well,
as per you, not per us.
This is really from you guys. Our first question was, you receive 10,000 rand, but you have 20,000 rand in debt, okay? Would you rather A, pay off your debt with the full 10,000 rand, or B, pay off a little and use the rest for holiday?
What did you go with here?
I didn't have to answer.
Okay.
And
what would you
do? I'm embarrassed to say what I would do.
You would go on holiday.
I would say it.
No, you would. You would go,
I'd go on holiday. And come back more rejuvenated to make some
to
more money and then pay off
the
my
challenges
debt.
At hand.
Ask
well,
that.
Thankfully, most people aren't like you and they just. No, they went with A, and well done to you for doing that. Pay off your debt, man. Yeah. Live stress free.
Yeah.
And then, of course,
the next question
we put to you guys was you receive 3,500 rand salary increase. Would you rather A, buy new clothes and nice things every month, or save it because you're doing fine without it? What would you choose?
What would you do?
I'd probably tell myself to save it.
Yeah.
And then spend
do the opposite of that.
I know what I should do.
Yeah. I would save it. If I was doing just fine without it, I would save it.
But that's like a new pair of shoes. So, come on. I don't know.
I'd save it.
But this one was undoubtedly super close, but the most popular answer was
save
option
it.
B, save it. Yeah. Well done. Well done, guys.
Our next question was, would you rather A, receive 2 million rand and never work again, okay? Which sounds good, right?
Yeah.
Or B, master 3 skills and have your pick at any high-paying job.
Thinking about the money makes me want to sneeze right now.
Please don't. I haven't got masks on. Come on.
But it's a tough one. No, I think for me it's all about mastering your skills, furthering your career, because ultimately you can make more than 2 million bucks.
Cool.
That's the plan.
Well, it was a super close one with this one, but most people were leaning towards option B, master 3 skills and pick a high-paying job. I like
2 million,
that.
2 million bucks would be
It's
cool,
not
though.
A lot.
Even if you burn through it in like 2 years, that's my problem.
That's the challenge.
So then our last conundrum is, would you rather earn 80,000 rand a month and hate your job, or earn 40K a month but love your job?
I answered this one.
You hate your job, yeah.
You remember. I said, I'll take the money and hate the job.
Take the money and run, man, because you can enjoy your life outside of that.
Yep.
But thankfully, by quite a large majority, you, the people, voted for option B, earn 40,000 rand and love what you do, man. Love it. And you can always get a raise later on. You guys are amazing. Thank you for being responsible. For being financially responsible. We really do. Thank you for sharing your answers with us. This really did spark some really interesting conversations. Yeah. And having honest conversations around money has been really, really gratifying. And I think we hopefully have inspired all of you to learn from this process and do it for yourself. And you can join us tomorrow for another round of
Would You Rather? The ultimate accessory. The latest shiny thing. Mesmerized, trying to keep up, but never getting ahead in an endless cycle of spending. In this world of constant upgrades, do you want a bank that takes your money, or a bank that takes your money seriously?
Welcome back. You're live with Expresso as we celebrate motherhood. Through the generations, every mother has worked hard to raise their children, but there is no doubt that motherhood in the modern day is very different. And despite having more resources and information at your disposal than ever before, mothers still feel overwhelmed and not quite sure if they're doing the right thing.
Ahead of Mother's Day this Sunday. Today we're asking, what is your experience of being a mother in the modern day? And clinical psychologist Asha Dilip is here today to help us discuss this and be taking your questions and comments via our Facebook page and our studio line, which is 021-110-5552. The number is on your screen right now, so do connect with us.
Mamas, call us.
Good morning, Mama.
Good morning. Hey, Mama.
Today, if you ask me that question, I'm going to say exhausted, because Luca did not sleep last night. And so, you know, it really is a balance, obviously, being a mom in the modern age, because you're having to multitask, balance everything, work and everything. Do you feel like there's a big difference between mamas back in the days, how our parents were raised, and mamas today?
Yes, I think we've moved from motherhood to mother load. And I think moms are feeling overwhelmed.
Say that louder.
Stressed, frustrated, trying to balance this work home. I think moms are looking for fulfillment. And I think that, you know, with that kind of search, there's a dynamic of multiple tasks that moms have to do. And that balance is quite hard. You know, gone are the days where we have this village to raise the kids. I think moms are feeling much more isolated.
Especially over the last year.
And there's a lack of support. And of course, in the last year, the pandemic, I mean, I can't imagine what new moms has been for them, because it's the lack of support. I mean, just breastfeeding support, antenatal classes. Moms haven't had that. And technology coming in with the digital age, I think moms are expected to be on demand 24/7. You know, a baby on the one hand and smartphone on the other hand.
Can I just send a shout out to Kath McGaw, who was a lactation specialist who came to our house. She was at Christian Barnard at the hospital, but then because we couldn't go back to the hospital, because my bubba was born on the second day of lockdown, Georgia, she actually came out to our the house and aided with that process. But I as a guy, I can't speak with authority here, because I've kind of gone through this last year and watched what Lindsay's has gone through in trying to offer support in that space. The biggest pressure point, undoubtedly, is time. There are moments where time stops and it's amazing and it's beautiful and you get the validation, enjoyment of kids. But more often than not, it feels like she has zero time for herself, and that time is probably the most important resource. How important is that time for yourself, and how do you get that right?
Time is very important, and I mean, we all are time bound, and it's really about giving yourself permission to take that time for yourself without any sense of guilt. I think that comes into play, because moms, when they do take time out, they feel guilty for taking that time out. So it's of utmost importance to take that time out, because you cannot give from a depleted, empty cup.
Yeah.
You need to fill your cup up, and your cup is actually more about yourself. When it overflows onto the source, the source is your children. And many people think that my cup just needs to be full in order to give, but it actually needs to be overflowing. And in this time-bound world, we are really struggling with that, with so many distractions and, of course, multitasking. You know, this whole term of doing more than one thing at the same time.
And I love that you say that, because I say this all the time, you have to be full. And sometimes, mothers, you have to be selfish. You have to be selfish to be selfless for your children. But obviously, coming into a modern day age where you have so many responsibilities, you're having to multitask, being a mom, being a working mom, how does one do it? How do we find a balance between this?
Well, you certainly can't master multitasking. I don't think you are meant to. You know, multitasking is seen as a super mom trait, but it's not. It's actually causing moms to be more distressed, more overwhelmed. And I think it's about really living more consciously as a mom, being more present, taking that time out, and just connecting more with your family and with your kids, and allocating that time for that, actually scheduling that in. I think that we are far too distracted, and we're not being present enough with our children, with our families.
Yeah, and talk about the kind of support that you need from your partner or your family, however, because we all have very unconventional family setups, so create that support around you. But, you know, just feeding off that, the idea, the notion of a cup, remember that your children learn from how you are, not what you tell them. So if you're exhausted and you're short-tempered and you are battling, that's what they're going to feed off. So make sure that you give yourself the time, because you're a mama.
And you deserve them. We want to hear from you. Please give us a call if you've got any comments or any questions. 021-110-5552 is the number to call. And you can also join us on Facebook and we'll continue the chat there.
It's so true. I mean, moms work overtime.
Yep.
It never ends. It never stops. And that's why we need to celebrate them. Take some time and say, Mom, we love you. Because Mother's Day is a celebration all about honoring our mothers. You know, because moms are really the heart of the home. And the mother figures, they are the glue keeping the family together. Your number one supporter, our number one cheerleaders, closest confidant. You name it. Soul teacher and the friend we all need.
Yeah, right? I couldn't agree with you more, Tubbs. And I wish we did this every day. But today, especially on Mother's Day, we need to celebrate and treat our moms to an overflowing day, full of love, full of laughter, and full of kindness.
I've just been thinking about the many options of things out there and available at Woolies to try and get my mom. It's a tough one because there is so much.
Yeah.
It's all about you know, how you elevate it and try and make it different. But for me, okay, you're about to be mind blown. Listen, I would give my mom this soft fleece pajamas set that you're seeing on there. It has a cozy long-sleeved top with a slogan, and it's got a heart on there, matching pants, because every mom loves some matchy-matchies.
And then you get
some elasticized, you know, waistband going on there, the pants as well. Just gonna love that. Of course, these ultra-luxe slipper boots. These are a hit with moms, eh?
When
moms are running around in the morning, getting their breakfast sorted for everybody else or for themselves, they love to wear these. I mean, I've seen many cool moms wearing these.
Wearing it outside.
What would you get for your mom?
Look, my mom's all about warmth, comfort, snuggling at night, and especially for winter. I think this grey shaggy throw is just an absolute perfect gift for my mom. She can cuddle up and she can kind of feel a little bit of that loving that I want to give her if I wasn't with her, of course. So to replicate the cuddles that I would give at home, this is going to be the perfect gift.
Of course, so do your cuddles feel like that?
Yeah, man.
Soft, warm,
beautiful textured.
Love it. Love
it. Of course, Mzani, too. If you want to know which of these two gifts we would like to get our moms or your moms, then you can head over to the Expresso Facebook page and choose. So we've got a poll happening and we want to pick one and let us know which is the favorite gift that you'd get for your mom. And of course you can get these at Woolies too, so head over in store, online, and as well as that app, and you can be shopping away for some incredible options when it comes to pleasuring, pleasing, and loving everything about Mother's Day.
I love your mom's blanket.
Yeah, man, it's so cool.
For my mama.
Oh, we are definitely going to be spoiling our mamas with a performance, for Stacy Francis is here. She's here to sing Purple Rain. You look beautiful.
Thanks.
Beautiful change.
Thank
and
you.
We are so happy to have you back one more time on the Feel Good Breakfast Show. So please take it away.
Thank you.
Never meant to cause you any sorrow. Never meant to cause you any pain. Only wanted one time see you laughing. I only wanna see you dancing in the purple rain. Purple rain, purple rain, purple rain, purple rain, purple rain, purple rain, yeah. I only wanna see you dancing in the purple rain. I never wanna be your wicked lover. And I only wanna be some kind of friend. Thank you. brand new. And that means you too. Woo!
You're live with S3. It's Monday, so we're talking all things relationships. And ahead of Mother's Day this Sunday, today we're asking, what is your experience of being a mother in the modern day? And we're back with clinical psychologist Asha Dulab to unpack this topic. So do weigh in with your questions and comments on our Facebook page and also our studio line, which is 021-110-5552. We'd love to connect with you. Welcome back.
Really interesting one, and from the gents' perspective, it's good to know what we need to do to help to support moms, because they have a dynamic that is completely different to ours. Obviously, both parents need to be involved, but I think now in this modern era, you know, it's no longer a case of kids must be seen and not heard. You need to be connected to your child. You need to know where they are. There needs to be an emotional growth, an EQ through that process. How do we keep that connection alive and start to foster, especially when it comes to mental health, that within our kids, so that they are self-aware and will look after their own mental health? Because surely that's got to start at an early age, like every other part of their development.
Well, Graham, you mentioned the key ingredient, which is EQ, and that happens through conversations about feeling. I think there's so much doing that we're not stopping and just being. When we are being, we can then tap into the feelings before we tap into the thoughts, and then we do. So I think have more conversations with your kids, but try not to only have those conversations when there's a crisis. Try and work on a preventative approach. Rather have those conversations before there's a crisis of any regard with your children.
That conversation isn't attached to trauma.
Exactly. Yes. So more engagement, more dinner times with your children, opportunities just to connect with them, whether you are, you know, engaging in a physical activity. Be playful. I think as parents, we need to become more childlike. That innocence, that curiosity, be curious about their lives, what they're doing, that discovery, that exploratory nature of just connecting. So as parents, let us be more childlike.
And there's a lot of entertainment value in asking your four-year-old a really deep and complex question. I mean, and we've spoken about death, and we've spoken about so many of these things, and it's amazing how aware they actually are.
Definitely. I love that you're mentioning staying connected and staying present with them, obviously in the mental space, because we've seen that change, and it's a conversation that we have to have in this day and age. But also with regards to physical health, we're seeing a lot more active lifestyle in kids. How do we then stay connected with that aspect of their lives?
Be active with your child. Go out on hikes, connect with nature, play sport, kick a ball with them, do the most simple things. I think what's really important with mothers is their own internal narrative and script as a mom. I think moms, you know, we're all about performing, trying to be perfect, trying to please. And with that comes the high expectations and the high judgment with it. I think that that takes away from that connection. You know, the whole script of I'm not a good enough mom, trying to please, trying to keep up with what everyone else is doing, comparing yourself to other moms, that is what's actually limiting the connection with kids today. So if moms can work on that and be more free in themselves, you know, really get to know who they are and be okay with what you are doing as a mom, remind yourself every day you are doing the very best you can each day.
And I'm going to say this, a happy mom is a happy child and you're doing good.
Yeah, completely. Yeah. Actually, just be the person that you say you are on Instagram, okay? Actually, do those things, feel those things, go and hike, enjoy the moment. No, it's hilarious. At my son's birthday, chatting with other parents and all professionals and everyone kind of successful in their own right, everyone feels like they're failing. Every single mom out there feels like she's not doing something right. So from a partner's perspective, how do we feel into the right kind of model to raise these self-aware children?
I think really just ask your kids, ask your partner first, what do you need? How can I help? It's four words that are profound, and also moms needing to ask for help as well in trying to raise kids that are mentally well, and of course keeping moms healthy mentally and physically, linking into that self-care that is so needed right now. Self-care comes in the relationship between the two partners as well, because when that is solid, the family is solid. So having conversation, checking in with your partner, and supporting each other's mental well-being.
It starts with you and feeds down to your kids, but we are celebrating motherhood at the moment, and we'd love to take your comments or your questions. 021-110-5552, give us a call.
Ah, looking forward to all of that. Now, ahead of Mother's Day, we asked you to vote for the gift that you would get your mum, either the pajamas or the shaggy throw. They're all so cozy and so fantastic for mum. The votes are in and they've been coming in fast and thick. We're ready to announce the Mother's Day comfort gift of the day, and there are many of them here. And I think it's safe to say that one of them is leading. But maybe we have a look at the comments. One of them is leading.
I mean, yeah, let's check the comments first before we just give out the results. So yeah. Sean Alpha says, the grey shaggy throw for my loving mother. That. I see you agreeing with me and my mom's choice over there. Joanne Price says, one soft fleece pyjamas. Nice one, Tubbs.
I love that.
We've got Tanya Pillay saying, the soft fleece PJ set. It does look good. I was feeling that earlier. I almost fell asleep.
And it's quite plenty as well. And I think mom doesn't have to worry about anybody using it on the couch. It looks like.
It's true.
Because this she'll wear all by herself.
Let's see the
cozy pajamas, and these boots are in the lead.
They are the comfort. Before we round it up, Tubbs Sago Bogoto saying soft fleece pajamas. We got Noreen Peterson saying number one, which is the PJs, and Chana Lee Clutty number one as well. So, without further ado, I think we definitely got a real winner. It's the PJ set, of course. Mom could not look better at night, cuddled up in those lovely PJs, Tubbs.
Absolutely. It's a comfort gift of note. Now, you have the opportunity to spoil your mum with a comfy gift set from Woolworths. Shop in store, go online or go on the app. There are so many of these incredible things and all sorts of colours and designs that you can pick for mum and show her that you truly do appreciate and love her.
Definitely one of the best intros for all of our guests, and we love her. Ashe is back. It's a Monday, so we are talking relationships, and in the context of Mother's Day this Sunday, we are asking, what is your experience of being a mother in the modern day? And we're back with our clinical psychologist and good friend, Ashe Dulab, of course, to unpack this topic. And we'll probably connect with a couple of your comments on Facebook as well, so keep the conversation going there.
Indeed.
Ashe, thank you for joining, because you can speak with authority because you study moms and you are a mom, so you feel that.
We spoke about it.
We spoke about it earlier. You get precedence today.
Absolutely. Everyone always needs us, you know, everyone always needs mom. But what happens if mom needs a break, if mom needs someone to lean on?
If mom needs mom. Yeah,
what then happens in that case?
Moms need to actually give themselves permission to take that time. And I think women need women in that regard to share in that dialogue of motherhood. I think that self-care is important in this regard. And self-care is not just about doing the nails and going for massages and sleeping in.
Which helps.
That
helps.
Don't discount that, eh? That stuff does help.
But it's also about setting those boundaries and being able to say no. Because when you say no to something, you say yes to yourself. And when you say yes, you're saying no to something else. So setting your boundaries so that it gives yourself more permission for taking that time out, for getting that cup to become, you know, full. Also just look at what you're surrounding yourself with. You know, there's, you know, toxic thoughts, toxic people that can really pull you and weigh you down and make you feel like a failure as a mom. What are the conversations that you're having around motherhood with other people, you know, because there's an atmosphere that one creates in the home. That actually draws on all our experiences.
Tap out. I need a tap out. Yes.
you've touched on it already. You tap out and then you can't enjoy yourself because you feel so guilty because you've abandoned your children. Your partner is who works and has to now manage the kids is having to kind of do this and he's not getting sleep and he's got to wake up at 4 tomorrow morning and. So mom ends up just sucking it up and getting back in the ring. How do we, in a concrete way, plan enough to be able to tap out without the guilt?
Mm-hmm. Well, we need to
Is it possible, first of all?
I think when a child is born, it comes with this experience of guilt comes with the child. And I think guilt is actually a protector of shame. And the shame is all those I messages, I'm not good enough, I need to be a better mom, you know, that comparing yourself to others. And I think it's about dealing with that in order to be able to really receive and take in what's around us, the help, the support, and also just being able to then take that time to for self-care. Mm-hmm. Because without addressing the guilt, we're going to remain stuck. I mean, moms are not only juggling, they are struggling at the moment. And we need to look at so many different aspects and layers of being a mom. Not just separate the role of a mom and the nurturer, but we are doing a lot, and moms are exhausted. Mm. And it's about actually just making the decision to say, I'm taking time out and giving yourself permission to do so.
And talk about it, yeah.
Yeah, and I love that we're having this conversation because just over the weekend we had this group of mothers. We just gathered. We just, you know, the kids weren't with us. And we just spoke. We spoke about things that's happening in this day and age.
Did you drink wine?
We didn't drink. I didn't drink.
I saw that on your Instagram,
yeah,
actually.
I had sparkling water out of a wine glass. But just having that group to be able to connect with and speak and say, you know what, I'm not okay. At the end of the day, I need help. I need this conversation. Just how important is having that space to speak with other mothers about what they're going through during this day and age?
It raises empathy. You know, the minute you start sharing your story, you hear me too. Yes, I agree with you. And that is the empathy and the compassion that we are raising for ourselves and for other moms. And where there's more compassion, there'll be less judgment because moms are being faced with being judged. Whether they're a good mom, whether they're a bad mom, they label themselves, I'm a bad mom, I'm a good mom. What is a good mom these days? You know, because we are in this mode of trying to be perfect, and in that we're actually just becoming more and more exhausted.
And talk to your partners. Don't expect him to know exactly how you're feeling or what you're going through unless you talk about it. Be present in that space, and then hopefully your partners can suck it up and get back in the ring as well and give you the support that you need, not just on Mother's Day, but every single day. Hopefully you found this interesting. I found it really, really helpful. Thank you so much. And once again, we just celebrate moms in the past era and moms in the modern era. We know how complex and difficult the job really is. So mamas, we love you.
Time for us to bring it back to the kitchen. Some kitchen inspiration. If you're looking for something hearty and delicious to make for Mother's Day lunch, you've come to the right place. We're making the ultimate veggie lasagna, which is brimming with tasty flavors, and it's all about slow cooking at its best, honestly. Now, Chef Clem is here in the house to show us how it's done. Chef Clem, good morning.
How are you?
I'm well, thank you. And you?
I'm so good, so excited to cook this dish.
I love what you've brought along here.
It's colorful, right? It's Moms will be very proud. We're eating our veggies.
Yeah.
And the thing is, we're not compromising on flavor. You're not going to miss the meat. This one is so delicious.
Yeah.
But there's a few tricks to kind of pump up the flavor and get the maximum, like, capabilities Richness. And flavors out of your veggies.
Well, Mummy's been saying, eat your veggies for all these years.
Right.
It's now time to feed Mummy the veggies.
Right.
All sorts of them as well. Listen, while we're making this and you want to be part of the action, go on to woolworths.co.za if you want the recipe. It's on there with all of the ingredients you're going to need for it. Chef Clem, let's get going.
Okay, cool. So the first thing we're going to do is start in our brinjal.
Okay.
And I took the top off.
Nice.
And we're going to cut like nice little steaks out of it. Oh, there we go. There we go. Mm. Nice steaks out of it. And we want to keep it nice and chunky. You don't want your veggies to be like too thin, because then it's going to disintegrate and cook away. You want to know what you're eating. So that's a very good size. You see what I'm saying? Like
that's
a
nice thick one.
So get
that's
that in.
Prime.
Prime.
Prime
rib.
Prime brinjal steak.
I like it, I like it. Okay. Then for your sweet peppers, and I absolutely love sweet peppers. Mm-hmm. They are so delicious. All you want to do is, you see the little green button on top there?
Yes.
Put your thumb on it, and you pop it in.
Oh, wow.
There we go. Then that goes inside. What you're going to do then is slice it open.
Slice it open, yeah.
Unravel it. There's your little core that you've taken out. And just give it a little tap.
That just cuts so much time off.
Just on the floor. Tap it out on the floor. All of it.
No,
just
joking.
I've got a bend down there.
Yeah.
No, okay. So then get that into the bowl as well.
Yeah.
Your courgettes, simplest thing. And these are so delicious as well. People don't cook enough courgettes. And I think it's because they don't know how.
But you also don't know how to bring them to life, right? You're like, once I've cooked it, then what am I going to add to it? How do I add some flavor? It's a tricky one, yeah.
Top and tail off. Again, keep it nice and chunky.
Okay.
So just into three chunky slices. Mm-hmm. Get it into your bowl. So now you've got your brinjal, you've got your baby marrow, you've got your sweet pepper, a little bit of salt. Actually, olive oil and salt. Olive oil first, so the salt will stick to it.
Okay.
There we go. I missed some salt. Bad luck if I just...
It's for good luck, right? It's for luck.
There we go.
Luck. So, for luck. Love it.
You're going to have the most amazing luck today.
The weekend stuff.
Mm. A nice, the weekend
cleansing
stuff.
All of
Can
the
I get
weekend.
Another kilogram of salt, please? I'm just trying to rebuke the weekend
just
stuff.
Cleansing. Okay. Let's go.
Onto a nice hot griddle pan.
Yeah.
We're going to get it nice and charry. This is where the flavor's going to come out. And brinjal and baby marrow, they get very smoky when you get them on like a nice griddle pan.
But do they not have like a lot of water? Because I worry about then, does it not become soggy? Like, how do you stop that? Like, is there, what's the process?
Nice high heat, okay?
You're gonna
see, it's like a steak.
Okay.
So when it goes down, you leave it, let it get that little char on it, and you want that. That's the most important thing. When you get that char, you seal it like you seal a steak. The moisture's not gonna go anywhere. It's gonna stay inside the veggies.
Retain it. I like that. Okay, cool.
Next thing. I've taken some cherry tomatoes, mm-hmm. garlic, which I've sliced, not chopped. It'll be a little different.
Okay.
And then some sun-dried tomatoes, and these are actually extremely sweet. They're so delicious.
Mm.
And olive oil. Cooked it together.
I love sun-dried tomatoes.
Beautiful little concentrate. You don't have to do this part. You can just lay it all in.
Okay.
But it's just nice to have this, and actually keep this in a jar, in the fridge, ready
That's
to go.
That's the thing. You can also have it with all sorts of other things later on as well. That's the versatility of this dish that we're making.
Lasagna is all about the layering, okay? So you get that sauce down first. Knock out the veggies.
Okay.
See how beautiful and smoky and charred that brinjal is?
Oh, yes,
get that down into your dish.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to make it like even more hot here, lentils, best friend. Get lentils in there.
Oh, my mom. Oh, my mom and my, not my mom-in-law. Not that, sorry, not yet.
Can I please get a chair? There's a conversation I'd like to have in the kitchen.
No, I'm not there at your zone yet, Chef Clem, but my stepmom, who's my mom, right?
Of course.
She loves lentils.
Loves lentils, and she's going to love this
one. We'll throw lentils into anything and everything.
Good for her. Good for her.
I'll be feeding you lentils for Mother's Day. Be on standby, Auntie.
Don't give her lentils for Mother's Day.
Well, they'll be part of the mix, right?
But I mean, don't give her a can of lentils for Mother's Day. You can give me, for my birthday, some lentils. I mean, I like lentils, but I mean, give your stepmom something else, something nicer.
No, I'm gonna throw them into the lasagna mix, man.
Okay. I've taken these lasagna sheets, and I just pre-cooked them a little bit just to get them nice and soft, and they fit perfectly. I didn't even plan that. They just fit perfectly. Now, my hack for Monday.
Okay, I wanna see this.
Bechamel sauce, and it's made with real cream. These are the things that you do to create like feastable dishes, but just, you make it more convenient. So you're not spending hours in the kitchen,
It's made with fresh cream. That's really the thing that makes it really
special,
right?
That's the thing. So you're not sacrificing on the flavor, the Woolies quality. It's
in
the bag.
Yeah.
Okay,
what's
in
the bag? That's a really good question. Some real cheese.
Real cheese.
Real cheese.
Real cream.
Cream
is in there. Okay, cool. That's down. Give it a good little spray.
Mm-hmm.
You see that? It turned into a little heart. I didn't even plan that. Tubbsy?
Oh, come on. You're going to
take this
all weekend.
You're going to take this one to your stepmom, eh? Done.
No, Mother's Day is still a while. But I suppose you can put it in the fridge for
you
a while.
You can freeze
right?
it. Thank you for that
about
one.
This.
Once you layer everything, you can actually freeze the whole dish and then take it out, let it thaw, and then you're good to go. Then pop it in the oven and you're happy. You're winning. Okay, more of the sauce goes on, more of those veggies.
It's so, so good. It looks so good. It looks so rich and just so scrumptious before it's even done.
It is.
I love this. And listen, it's going to be a mummy pleaser of note. And you want to make sure that you make this for your mum. And if you do, go onto the website, Woolworths.co.za. It's Woolworths.co.za. It's there. All the ingredients you're going to need, they've loaded them there, as well as a step-by-step guide of how to bring it all together.
Some pecorino romano.
Oh, my favorite.
Okay. A little sharper than Parmesan cheese and a couple of little shavings. Just crumble it over the top.
And it'll melt nicely.
Oh, beautifully. Ooh,
can
beautifully.
You imagine that?
It goes into the oven and it comes out smelling so delicious.
That's where the smell's coming from. Look at what the final product looks like, guys. I mean, this is so, so impressive.
Right?
Wow. Are you going to cut it for me?
I feel like I knew you were about to ask, so let's just do this.
Wow, this is so good. It smells really good. I love how the cheese has set nicely on top of everything there.
I'm going to take this out the way here so I can get a nice little base. Mm. Tubbsy?
Yeah?
This is the one, okay?
This is a love meal. It's a love dish of note.
Making sure I got everything in this little piece that you're going to get now.
Love dish.
Okay, that's a good one. That's a good one.
It says home, it says warmth, it says love, all of those things.
Tell me if you miss the meat at all when you try this, okay?
Okay, cool.
Because you're not going to. Okay, that's a TV-sized portion.
Mm. Okay, let's get in there. Mm. I want to make sure I get everything in.
Tubs,
and how long would this take to prepare?
Half an hour.
Oh, yeah?
Everything's cooked already, so you just want to warm it through. I'm just going to say to the viewers at home, Tubbsy is only quiet in studio when he's eating. So if we ever don't hear Tubbsy, he's eating. Mm. We know this. Tubbsy, are
we winning? You know what I forgot to mention?
What?
It's so deliciously crunchy as well.
That's the thing about lasagna.
The crunch is so good. Coming together with our tomato sauce that you made. Mmm.
Ah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes. Ah. Are you going to be sharing with anyone in studio?
Yeah, Graham can share.
Okay, Graham.
No.
Graham.
And Jamie. Oh. And Ryle. You missed any of the steps here. This is so delicious. Any other steps here? You missed them? Watch this, all right? Until you're going to get a plate.
It's my feel-good breakfast show.
Back you beautiful souls. We're still right here live on S3, opening up with the magic. And we're opening up with one special soul. Stacy Francis, still in the building. And we learned so much from her this morning. Of course, a voice that is all kinds of juicy. And we're about to add some extra juicy, fruity fun to ensure that she has a juicy kaboom day with Maynard's job gum and jellies. Stacy, you've been an absolute breath of just pure fire today.
Thank you
Your
so much.
Your voice range is like, I can't even imagine.
Thank you.
You literally give me shivers. And thank I know you. It's never going to be a big enough thank you, but we try our best. So from the studio myself, we've got this beautiful job, Maynard's for you.
That's so sweet.
Be careful though, when I hand this over to you, crazy things happen.
And really?
I'm just saying, watch out. But this is for you.
That's so sweet.
It's a juicy cup.
For sure. It's so cute. Thank you so much. That's so nice. So thank you for having me.
No, thank you for coming on South Africa, sharing your beautiful gifts, your talent, and using your time to not just show it off, but you're doing something incredible with some of the kids down in our country. So thank you for sharing the love. You're doing so much magic. And
it's such
one
an
last
honor.
Time, we're getting the opportunity right now to hear a performance from you that I believe you wrote during that COVID-19 pandemic,
That's right. It's called We Stand Together. I partnered with a company in America called American Power and Gas, and we fed over 20,000 meals in Brooklyn, New York City, which obviously aligns with my work in Africa and America, and I wrote this song and with a band called the Flag Band in America, so I'm really honored to sing it today for you.
Oh, well, it's an absolute privilege to have you here. We can't wait. Let me take that off
Thank
your hands.
You.
I'll protect it for you.
Thank you.
Because I know everybody's going to want a piece of this, but
Thank
we
you.
Stand together from Stacy Francis. Ladies and gentlemen,
Thank you.
The pleasure is all hers. Yes.
Come on, clap your hands at home. Hey. Yep. Yeah.
Consequences growing clearer. Look at yourselves now in the mirror. We ain't the kind to fade or wither. Never solve it by crying a river. We can unite, keeping our distance. Nothing can weaken our resistance. It's an attack on our immunity, but it won't break our community. No, the land might run it hard abandon. Not us, America. Show what we believe, cause we can count on American unity. We stand behind all our brothers, though we may come from different mothers. Our nation's common found the fathers, his countrymen and our family. No, the land might run in hot abandon, not us, America. We'll jump. Not a single one of us. Stand alone, not alone. We're fighting our emotion. Yeah.
We love you. We'll see you tomorrow.
We love you, Stacy Francis!
Wow. Yeah. Mwah. Mwah.
Here's to one last slice of summer and our first taste of autumn. Made with love by Clover.
Never feel good production.